Good afternoon. My name is George Thompson, and I want to welcome you to this remarkable program this afternoon at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. It's my pleasure to wear two hats. One is to be an associate professor with the Department of the History and Philosophy of Medicine, University of Kansas, as well as being an academic advisor for the museum in its education program. So we're delighted to welcome you to this very unique program, Impact of World War I on the Nursing Profession. Today is especially important because it gives us an opportunity to recognize the importance that nurses played in World War I, and to welcome you to this extraordinary museum, which is the nation's museum and memorial, solely dedicated to the understanding and education about World War I. As you can see today from your program, we have a very busy agenda. You'll have two sessions, which you'll see on your program as presented by our illustrious scholars and practitioners. So I think it's at, let me look at my program. I think it's at 3 o'clock, we'll have a 15-minute break. And during that time, there will be coffee, water, refreshments out in the corridor where you came in. And also the all-important bathrooms. There's one right by the auditorium entrance as you passed, but also there's one down on the west corridor near the cafe. So in case you feel so inclined to use the facilities, they're there. If at any time you feel like you need to get up and leave, please feel free to do so. There's a remarkable exhibit, excuse me, down on the research floor level. The exhibit will close today at 3, so I don't think that we'll be finished in time for you to be able to see it, but I urge you to come back. It's a show curated by Stephen Goddard from the University of Kansas Spencer Museum called The Second Battlefield, Nurses in the First World War. Now, of course, any program like this has so many people involved in bringing it together, but we especially want to thank Dr. Charles Van Way and family and Dr. Vincent and Liz Lim, whose support of the museum has helped make this program possible. I'd now like to introduce my colleague, Dr. Moya Peterson, who's an associate professor with the University of Kansas School of Nursing. Thank you.
Hello, I want to thank you all for coming on this beautiful day. I know that some of you would have liked to have been outdoors, but this is a remarkable event and very unique. It's probably the only event we know of in the country that talks about nursing in World War I. I am Dr. Moya Peterson. I'm a teacher up at the School of Nursing as well as a family nurse practitioner. We have been so thrilled to be able to collaborate with the museum and to bring this program to you. And please know that our presenters and planners for this program have nothing to disclose related to the presentation content. There's no commercial support for this event. And a sincere thank you goes to the National World War I Museum and Memorial for providing event space, financial support, and to offset the cost of programs advertising to a very broad constituency. We also want to thank the School of Nursing for their contribution of funds, manpower, and the complimentary contact hours for the nurses. Immediately following this program, you will be emailed a link to the SurveyMonkey evaluation that take only a few minutes to complete. If you would complete that survey as soon as you receive the email, we would be grateful. Thereafter, contact hour certificates will be sent to you if you are a nurse participant that would like those hours. And be sure to have be sure that you got registered at the registration desk if you desire to have those hours. I'd like to introduce the planning committee. Some are in here and some are not, but Dr. Rita Clifford, retired associate dean of the School of Nursing, has been worked tirelessly in her retirement to make this program go. George Thompson, we've enjoyed working with him. Jan Frecki has worked with the continuing education credit hours and made that possible for you. Also, Laura Vogt, Mike Veer, and Cherie Kelly from the museum have spent countless hours preparing this program as well. I would like to introduce to you Dr. Sally Maliski. She's our dean at the School of Nursing, and have her bring greetings to you from the school.
Well, welcome, everyone. This is exciting. It's wonderful. And we want to welcome you and thank you all for coming from the School of Nursing. So this is really a unique and exciting event. The presentation of nurses and nursing as depicted in the exhibition here at the museum and the outstanding presentation you're going to hear is a story that is very little known, and we're very happy that it's being brought to you. We're grateful to the museum for recognizing the importance of this presentation related to nursing in World War I, and again to acknowledge that this event has been many months in the preparation. I'd like to especially thank Dr. Moya Peterson and Dr. Rita Clifford for all the hard work that they've been doing, and along with the partnership with the museum. Now, I have to say that I had the pleasure of hearing this presentation this morning. So you are in for a treat as we listen to these expert and engaging speakers throughout this presentation. So now, if you would, just sit back, relax, listen, and enjoy. Thank you all.
I'd like to take this opportunity now to introduce to you our speakers. Dr. Sanders Marble graduated from King's College in London with his PhD in military history, especially World War I. He is the senior historian in the Office of Medical History in the U.S. Army in San Antonio, Texas, at Fort Sam Houston. Prior to that, he's held positions with the Smithsonian Institution and has taught medical history at several different universities. He has written many books, articles, and chapters, and in 2013, he was awarded the Department of the Army Achievement Medal for Civilian Service, and in 2015, he was awarded the Global War on Terrorism Civilian Service Award. He has presented and organized conferences in the United States and around the world for military history, and also volunteers to the U.S. World War I Centennial Commission. Dr. Marble. Colonel Richard Pryor is the Chief Nursing Officer and Deputy Commander for Nursing at the Ireland Army Community Hospital in Fort Knox, Kentucky. He received his BSN from Creighton University in Omaha, and most recently his Doctorate of Nursing Practice from George Washington University in Washington, D.C. He's a family nurse practitioner, so close to my heart. He also was the chief of the Office of Medical History and the Office of the Surgeon General at the Pentagon, and he's served in a variety of roles in places like Somalia, Kuwait, and several different bases in the States. He has won multiple awards, such as the 2014 Outstanding Alumni Award from the Uniformed Service University, and 2012 the Order of the Military Medical Merit Award, and in 2011 he was selected as a fellow in the American Association of Nurse Practitioners. He has also received numerous military honors. He has published in peer-reviewed journals and contributed many chapters to a variety of textbooks for family nurse practitioners. He has presented to audiences across the states and around the world on military and medical topics. Thank you for your service, Dr. Pryor. Colonel Elizabeth Betsy Vane. Colonel Vane is the Army Nurse Corps historian in San Antonio, Texas at Fort Sam Houston. She graduated with her BSN from Winona State University in Winona, Minnesota, and received her master's in nursing from the University of Colorado Health Sciences in Denver, Colorado. She has taught and has consulted in the Office of the Army Surgeon General and has served at Walter Reed National Military Medical Center, Army hospitals in El Paso, Texas, Aurora, Colorado, Berlin, and Landstuhl Regional Medical Center in Germany. Her area of expertise is in perioperative nursing, and she is a member of the advisory board for the AORN. She also has many publications and presentations in the States and globally about medical issues and the history of military issues, or nursing issues, I'm sorry. Thank you for your service, Colonel Vane. We would like to take just a moment to recognize any military nurse, current, reserve, retired, in the audience, if you'd please stand. Thank you. All right, I'll now turn the meeting over to the speakers.
Good afternoon, everybody. When the United States entered the Great War, the Army Nurse Corps was only 16 years old. In April of 1917, there were 403 Army nurses on active duty. 22 months later, there would be 22,000 Army nurses on active duty. And these 22,000 Army nurses would come out of a total population of about 60,000 nurses in the United States. These nurses provided care to hundreds of thousands of soldiers in over 260,000 hospital beds in France by the time of the armistice. And today we're going to do our best to tell you the story of how these ordinary people, people just like you, did extraordinary things. It's a tremendous honor for us to be here at the National World War Museum supporting the exhibit on nurses in World War I. And also thank you to the University of Kansas School of Nursing. Three of us are here today because we're passionate about the history of military nursing, and it's an absolute pleasure for us to be here this afternoon to talk to you. And it is great for me to be here today with my two friends who I haven't seen for a long time. So this is a picture of General Jack Pershing. And General Pershing was the equivalent in World War I of General David Petraeus or General Norman Schwarzkopf or General Eisenhower in World War II. He was the commander of the American Expeditionary Force, which was the name for the 4 million man army that would serve in World War I. And with him standing in the mud, which was so typical of World War I, are two Army nurses. So because this is continuing education, these are your obligatory objectives. We're not going to spend a tremendous amount of time today discussing the war itself and the execution of the war itself. Really, what we're here for is to help you understand what it was like to be a nurse in the Army in World War I, and what hospitalization was like, and what patient care was like. So we hope that that's what you'll get out of this presentation, and maybe a little bit of appreciation about what the lessons learned were for the Army and society in general from having these nurses participate in World War I. More obligatory objectives. So you can say in SurveyMonkey that we showed you the objectives. So nursing in the military dates back to the War of Independence. And although family members occasionally cared for ill or injured soldiers, inadequate help frequently required that General Washington pull soldiers off the line in order to take care of sick service members. So because of this, the Second Continental Congress responded in 1775 with funds for medical support. And it authorized a ratio of one nurse to every 10 patients, not too shabby, and one matron to supervise the nurses at each camp. And for this work, which included caring for the sick, preparing a patient's food, and doing miscellaneous housekeeping duties, a sum of $2 a month plus one meal per day was paid. And it was difficult to find people to take these jobs because they could actually earn more money doing the soldiers' laundry. So nursing in the Civil War was done by a hodgepodge of those who were hired and those who were volunteered. Dorothea Dix was hired by the Union Army to find suitable nurses to employ. But there wasn't agreement over who was to be selected or how they were to be selected or how they were to be used. So the experiment of having Dorothea Dix recruit nurses was largely considered to be a failure. And Dix ended up resigning from the Army in 1865. Several orders of Catholic nuns also provided nursing care, but they didn't always agree with the army either. Nursing was also provided by people like Clara Barton. After the First Battle of Bull Run in July of 1862, wounded soldiers were evacuated to homes and churches in the Washington, D.C. area. And her landlord, a lady by the name of Almira Fales, persuaded her to move forward and start providing care on the battlefield itself. But initially, Miss Barton wasn't particularly welcomed by the Army, believing that she would hinder their efforts. So, for example, on the night before the battle at Antietam, the roads were completely clogged with soldiers and supplies, and she just couldn't get onto the battlefield. And it wasn't so much that they didn't want her there, although they didn't particularly feel strongly that she should be there. It was just a matter of the fact that they had to get the soldiers the supplies on, and medical care wasn't a priority. So what that required that she did was the night before the battle, when all the soldiers were pulled over on the side of the road, she rounded up her wagons and had to move out on the roads at night. She would bring medical supplies to the battlefield. She'd provide care to the wounded. She assisted surgeons at the Hasty Field Hospitals that were adjacent to the battlefield. And eventually, she'd be stricken by typhoid. And after a month's rest, she rejoined the Army at Harper's Ferry and then moved on to Fredericksburg. And during that brutal battle, she and poet Walt Whitman worked together as nurses assisting the regimental surgeon of the 21st Massachusetts. And eventually, she provides some care on the battlefield to some of the biggest and most grimmest battles of the war, to include the sieges at Petersburg, Virginia, and at Richmond. And throughout the war, she continued to work independently. She had to fight off attacks from the Sanitary Commission and the Christian Commission, who believed that they should be the sole distributors of battlefield care. In 1864, though, she was appointed by Union General Benjamin Butler as the lady in charge of the hospitals at the front of the Army of the James. But really, the story of nursing in the military begins in the Spanish-American War, late in 1897. The USS Maine was sent into the Havana Harbor as a show of strength and to protect US interests in Cuba's revolt against Spain. And on the 15th of February, the Maine spontaneously exploded and sunk. And nobody really knows why. Maybe it hit a mine. Maybe the coal bunker blew up. Nobody really knows for sure. But the newspaper publishers, William Randolph Hearst and Joseph Pulitzer, wanted to sell papers, and they blamed Spain. And they fanned the flames of war, popularizing the saying, "Remember the Maine and to hell with Spain." And war was essentially declared on Spain on April 11th, 1898. So the Army then had to mobilize, and it mobilized in the southern United States, and it deployed to Cuba, Spain, and Puerto Rico. And one of the defining characteristics of this war was squalor in camps. And that was a little bit ironic, because the Surgeon General at the time, a guy whose name was George Miller Sternberg, was one of the preeminent infectious disease physicians in the war. And he was one of the guys that really pioneered concepts of field sanitation in the Army. But he didn't have a lot of sway over the contract physicians that provided care in the camps and the line commanders. And they found that his field sanitation requirements were cumbersome. It got in the way of packing as many guys as you could into one tent or putting the tents as close together. And they didn't particularly believe the evidence that things like washing hands before you ate would do things to curb disease. So they ignored him. And as a result of what was essentially negligence of employing evidence-based practice and field hygiene techniques, preventable diseases like diarrhea and typhoid and malaria reached epidemic proportions. So the Surgeon General Sternberg, again, preeminent infectious disease physician, field sanitation pioneer, was hoping that the hospital corps of enlisted men would adequately provide nursing care, but it just didn't work out, and they became overwhelmed with these squalid disease conditions. So he decided the best thing to do would be to bring in nurses as contractors. And the way that he did it was he hired Dr. Anita Newcomb McGee. Now, she was a prominent obstetrician in Washington, D.C. She was a member of the Daughters of the American Revolution, and she was a little bit of a socialite. And Dr. McGee began organizing nurses under the Daughters of the American Revolution, and then in the event that they'd be needed to support the military in the Spanish-American War. And the way that she did this was she screened them and she made sure that they were the right candidates. So as a result, Sternberg recognized that he needed her help, and he appointed her as the assistant surgeon general in charge of screening and recruiting in nurses. And over the course of a few months, she and her staff put 1,500 nurses into the Army, and she deployed them to the theater and the camp hospitals. And the nurses didn't get anywhere near the front lines because being at the front was way too dangerous for girls. But there was a typical pattern that they saw as they brought nurses and women into the Army for the first time. At first, nobody liked it. There was reluctance by both the physicians in the camp and by the line commanders. And then slowly they warmed to it. And then they realized that the nurses were making a difference in the morbidity and mortality on the battlefield, and then they wanted more. So slowly over time, these nurses became extraordinarily helpful in caring for patients stricken with like typhoid and yellow fever. The war didn't last long. It only lasted about 4 months. The United States won, and it effectively ended Spain's reign as a world power. But the United States wasn't pleased. Americans thought that their sons and daughters were going to go to war, and they were going to die from combat. They didn't think they were going to go to war and die from diarrhea and typhoid. And they weren't happy. So President McKinley appointed Civil War General Greenville Dodge to chair a commission to conduct a comprehensive after-action review of the war. And it started off by looking at how the Army acquired tainted beef. But the scope and the depth of this commission spread. And really, they started to look at all kinds of topics about how the Army supported soldiers in the war. And in the review of healthcare, this commission found that Army Medical Department couldn't and didn't provide efficient or adequate nursing care. And they recommended that there be a reserve corps of nurses who would serve in the event of a national emergency. And you have to understand how radical this was, because at no point before this had women ever been recommended to be part of the Army. So if the Army Nurse Corps was born on February 2nd, 1901, it was conceived right here in this document and through this process as part of the lessons learned of the Spanish-American War. Now, for the next couple of years, there would be a lot of debate about what nursing should look like in the Army. Because, like I said, this is a fairly radical concept. We were bringing women into the military. And there's all kinds of questions. Should men be allowed? No. That wouldn't come until 1955. Should nurses have rank? Should they have uniforms? Should they have retirement programs? And a lot of prominent members of the community weighed in. Leaders within nursing, politicians, general officers in the Army. And Dr. Anita Newcomb McGee was intimately involved with crafting the first legislation. So the Army Reorganization Act was signed into law on February 2nd, 1901, and it established an active duty nurse corps of all females, of about 100 women. It set pay and it established that the superintendent had to be a nurse, which meant that Dr. Anita Newcomb McGee had to resign. The first Army nurses just wore whites. They had no official uniform. They didn't have any title. They referred to as miss or nurse. And they simply wore this green Maltese cross that you see here on their whites as a symbol of their affiliation with the Army. And the document that you see here is the general order appointing Dita Kinney as the first superintendent of the Army Nurse Corps. It's signed by the Surgeon General, and she worked as an assistant to Dr. Anita Newcomb McGee during in the Surgeon General's office during the Spanish-American War. And she was the superintendent until 1909, when she was basically forced to resign by one of the subsequent surgeons general over what was effectively irreconcilable differences. And unfortunately, the first superintendent of the Navy Nurse Corps had much a similar fate. So the first years were difficult and not without trials and travails.
So to better set the stage to describe Army nursing at the declaration of war, this slide shows the then and now. So today, Army nurses understand that we are a soldier first, because who else is going to help you put your gas mask on? You're an officer second, and you're a nurse third. But before and during World War I, nurses, although part of the Army, were considered as they were not enlisted, they were not commissioned, and they were not warrant officers. Uniformed female nurses at this time were not accorded the same treatment as uniformed men, as it was a female-only corps by law. And so the nurses ended up with a paramilitary status throughout the war, and they were called Miss or Nurse because of that. They were given acting rank only for the duration of the war and only three ways, Lieutenant, Captain, or Major. And this status, is, you'll see as we continue here, will lead to several problems, because when there is a war, and when you have this type of status where you're sort of something but not, and you're denied this but you're something else, this is going to affect your pay, your mail, and traveling, and housing, and many other things, because you are going to be bumped in favor of those that do have a status. Today, the Army Nurse Corps is looking for educated nurses, and they will provide avenues for nurses to acquire additional education. In World War I timeframe, the British and French governments also requested that only graduate-trained nurses be sent overseas. They did not wish for nursing aides to replace these nursing requirements. Today, the Army Nurse Corps has 12 different specialties, where in World War I, there were a few specialties, and this, of course, mirrors society as well. In 1916, Army nurses received no combat or weapons training, and today we do receive training, and we follow the warrior ethos, which would be 4 points. I will always place the mission first. I will never accept defeat. I will never quit. I will never leave a fallen comrade. So in World War I, nurses were to serve, but only in the safe areas, certainly not at the front. Just prior to the declaration of war in April of 1917, there were 403 Army nurses that served on active duty, and within that group were 170 in the reserves. And the American Red Cross had almost 8,000 nurses in their reserves. But these are not enough nurses to fight the war to end all wars. The Army's guide for estimating the required numbers of nursing had remained unchanged since the Revolutionary War, which is one nurse for every 10 hospital beds. The Army mandated during World War I that nurses serve for the duration of the emergency, which at that time was an undetermined amount of time. On this slide, you see the American National Red Cross nurse pin and the Army Nurse Corps caduceus, with all three letters, ANC, Army Nurse Corps, superimposed on that pin. With regard to uniforms, Colonel Pryor and I are wearing current Army uniforms. I'm wearing the duty or working uniform, the fatigues, and Colonel Pryor is wearing the dress uniform. Uniforms have evolved over time, and I, for one, am glad to be able to wear pants with cargo pockets. With cargo pockets on the side. At first, the Army wished for the Nurse Corps to wear white dresses, and you were to wear red lipstick, and you were to make the fighting man feel safe. And if it was only that easy, we could be well decorated for dresses and red lipstick. So we're not allowed to wear pants until 1942, which is another war, but I just have to tell you this. And we did not have front zippers until the 70s. So if you would like to go on a speaking circuit with us, you can wear the uniforms that tuck in with the button sides, because that is not my favorite. So. And we also were taught that you're only as good as your equipment or tools. So when you see photos of the Army nurses of World War I today, watch what they're wearing. They're going to have dresses, aprons, little dress boots with lots of eyelets, and they are not speed laced. And please contrast to what we're wearing today and imagine how easy or hard nursing tasks would have been to perform given those puzzle pieces. Now, the government did provide lectures and vaccinations, smallpox, shots, typhoid, paratyphoid, and forms, but they did not provide uniforms for the Army nurses. So by default, the Red Cross contributed to the nurses' clothing needs for the duration of the war. And only in 1922 did the government reimburse the Red Cross for all of that effort. Uniforms are easily identifiable means to see which country, which branch, and which service a nurse belonged to. These nurses are wearing the outdoor uniform. Today we can wear whatever we wish, sort of, kind of, when not on duty. But these gals were told exactly what to wear, and then that's what's on this slide. In May 1917, the Surgeon General told the War Department it was absolutely necessary to have an outdoor uniform for these Army nurses, and it was to be olive drab and wool. But the sudden increased demand of olive drab material for the fighting soldiers made this difficult to obtain. And that's when the Red Cross stepped in with a blue serge dress, a heavy blue overcoat. You can't tell it's blue because it's a black and white slide, but they are blue. Everyone thinks we're green. Rich is a little blue. I'm sort of digital and green, but anyway, they were all blue, and they had a wide-brim velour hat. They had a straw hat for summer. They had a felt hat for winter, dark tan shoes, and gloves. And what you'll see them wearing is the insignia U.S. and the caduceus with the ANC superimposed on the collar of their jackets. Now, if you were a nurse who volunteered to go overseas and support the war effort, and all these nurses volunteered, we have never drafted women yet in the U.S., and we have never forced anyone to go overseas against their will. So if you volunteered to go overseas and support the war effort, what would you pack in your trunk? And whatever you pack, you have to carry, because unless you have very, very good friends that are strong, they're not going to carry their stuff and your stuff. So you can read the list. I tried to make the letters as big as I could here, but you do notice you get 12 sets of white collars and cuffs. You'll get a dozen hose, bed socks, two pair of black tights, and a trench cap. So this is one style of trunk that may have held Army nurses' belongings. And then putting, Did I jump massively ahead?
That's right.
Oh, I'm so slide happy with these punching things. You just, ooh, look, it's three, we're done. So, how did that happen? Yes. I no longer can play piano for the church because when they nod like this, I play the benediction and we're done. I'm be restricted from the clicker here. Despite their official a position as a member of the military, nurses were sometimes seen as civilian interlopers, well-meaning yet ill-informed meddlers, who were as much a distraction to discipline as they were angels of healing and support. And the confusion over the place of women in wartime reflects how the First World War was an important point in changing status of women in culture and society. And World War I was the first armed conflict that the U.S. Army entered into with an established cadre of nurses. This is a portrait of Elizabeth Lienhouts taken in New York in a photo studio on Broadway in New York City. This was taken before she sailed for France. She was a member of U.S. Army Base Hospital 22 based in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. She was 35 years old. She'd been a nurse for 9 years. She is wearing the Army nurse outdoor wool uniform, and she has her U.S. and caduceus on her collars. Of interest, her much younger brother served in the same unit as an orderly. And at the end of World War I, her World War I Victory Medal had 5 battle clasps and the defensive sector clasp. This is nurse Elizabeth Lewis from New England. She worked in U.S. General Hospital No. 9 in Lakewood, New Jersey, and also in France, from late August of 1918 till March of 1919. She describes her training and experiences to her mother and sisters through letters she sent home, and we will hear her words several times. Nurse Estelle Hines is shown on the left wearing the authorized white uniform. At first, Army nurses wore the white cotton starched duty form. However, when stationed overseas, treating war casualties, this uniform quickly became soiled with blood, wound drainage, and mud. Without laundry facilities and hot water, it was a better choice to be authorized to wear a gray dress. First, it was crepe, but the cold, damp weather dictated the wearing of something warmer, and it went to a gray jersey dress. On the right is an example of the gray ward or indoor uniform, and pictured here is Nurse Helen Grace McClellan, who was a graduate of Pennsylvania Hospital School of Nursing, served in France and Belgium with Base Hospital Number 10, and you will hear more about her later in this presentation. And you will notice that she's got a white butcher-style apron, you had six of those in your trunk, and a white detachable collar and stiff white detachable cuffs, because they were easier to keep white than the entire dress was. As the nurses continued working overseas in this uniform, and as the weather deteriorated, they needed to add another layer of clothing. One nurse wrote that nurses in her unit wore a raincoat over a jersey or a gray crepe uniform, rubber boots, and a sou'wester's hat. No wonder that the mademoiselles asked our soldiers, "Are all American women so homely?" The history of Base Hospital Number 1 noted, many of the nurses appeared for the first time in their war uniforms, nun-like in their gray and white simplicity, clown-like after the first washing with strips of purplish gray fading into sickly white. This particular dress was worn by Nurse Cora Elderton, who served with Base Hospital Number 51. Her unit landed in France in August 1918, moved to a forward position, and while she was there, they got patients directly from the front and treated more than 12,500 patients. One of the iconic symbols for a nurse during the 20th century was the cape. World War I Army nurses were issued a blue wool cape with a maroon wool lining that was to be worn over this hospital dress. The cape in this photo was worn by Army nurse Esther Kemp, who was assigned to Walter Reed General Hospital in Washington, D.C. And the shoes you see are worn by Army nurse Gertrude Hartman, and they provided support for her ankles and her arches, and she had room in the toes for hours of standing. And she served with Base Hospital Number 72. The caduceus you see again, the close-up, the ANC, is from World War I, and the caduceus with the N, just the N, is what we currently wear today. The navy blue fur hat with grosgrain ribbon on the left was worn with the navy blue outdoor uniform, and this one was worn by Nurse Gertrude Hartman, Base Hospital Number 72. The trench art painted on the Brodie steel combat helmet pictured on the right belonged to Nurse Vashti Bartlett. She was a 1906 graduate of Johns Hopkins University, and from March 1915 to January 1916, she served with the American Red Cross in France and Belgium, and she was fluent in French. From March of 1917 to August of 1918, she was Clara Noyes' assistant in the Department of Nursing Bureau of Field Nursing Service, Red Cross Headquarters, Washington, D.C. And then in August of 1918, she returns to France, but this time she's an Army Nurse Corps nurse, and she's chief nurse of Base Hospital Number 71. And after that assignment, she goes to Siberia as a member of the Siberian Expeditionary Forces, where she combats a hantavirus. So there are times that we think we do cool things with Ebola and then go back to 1919 and handle a hantavirus. The third nurse in and the very last row in on the left there is Miss Vashti Bartlett. This is during her time as a Red Cross nurse. And here is a non-black and white picture of the blue silk blouse that you would have worn with your outdoor off-duty uniform. Now, the nurse who wore this uniform is Army Nurse Hazel Bell Flint. And while she was in France, she was told to report to Base Hospital Number 89. Number 52. And when she gets there, she is immediately moved to this next hospital, Base Hospital Number 89. So she records in her diary, "I'm on duty in a borrowed uniform because my suitcase is still at the railroad station. I have charge of a ward with 86 patients. No nurse has been there. Poor lights here. I have to use a candle at night. Now on to chief nurses. Chief nurses were very important. They oversaw the quality of patient care given by the nursing staff. They also advocated for their nurses' well-being. This photo is of nurse Julia Stimson. She's on the right. She was chief nurse of Base Hospital number 21, and sitting next to her is nurse Taylor. They are waiting for the time of evening report, says the caption. Julia Stimson went on to be director of the nursing service of the American Expeditionary Forces and chief nurse of the American Red Cross in France. After World War I, she is superintendent of the entire Army Nurse Corps from 1919 to 1937, and she served as president of the American Nursing Association 1938 to 1944. Now, during World War I, chief nurses were to be selected by promotion from the grade of nurse, and they were to be assigned to duty when two or more nurses were serving at the same station, and they had to pass an examination before being promoted to that status. And chief nurses could not be assigned to duty permanently except by the Surgeon General. This photo shows nurse Julia Stimson with no real rank, standing in formation with officers in France, and this is significant because she's being recognized for her contributions as a chief nurse and is on par with the male officers. Within the base hospital structure, which eventually formed the backbone of U.S. Army medical support in France, the local medical director appointed the chief nurse. She, in turn, selected her complement of nurses, nurses' aides, and a dietitian who was also a nurse, and they all had to meet Army Nurse Corps and Red Cross standards. As the number of patients and Army nurses increased, so did the complexity of nursing administration. At Walter Reed General Hospital in Washington, D.C., the principal chief nurse supervised all nurses and all their activities. Her responsibilities included the administration of the nurses' quarters. She monitored the performance of women kitchen and women housekeeping workers, and she supervised dietitians' records. The assistant principal chief nurse provided necessary assistance to her superior. Day and night supervisors daily inspected the wards. They paid special attention to seriously ill patients, the quality of the diets, and the protection and dispensing of liquor and habit-forming drugs. The Army Appropriation Bill of July 1918 somewhat improved the benefits for Army nurses. Their pay increased from $50 to $60 a month in the U.S. and from $60 to $70 overseas. But the chief nurse's pay inadvertently suffered a decrement. Chief nurses had received $30 a month more than staff nurses. This bill decreased their bonus to $10 a month, and this unintended measure caused great consternation and eroded the morale of the chief nurses. And in February 1919, Congress rescinded that portion and retroactively awarded the chief nurses the pay that was denied them. And now, this next segment, we go into staff nurses, their working conditions and what things would look like, their roles and responsibilities. Diary accounts detail how enlisted men grew to appreciate and follow the instructions of women without rank when it pertained to patient care, especially when the women exhibited stamina, creative problem solving, and a sense of humor while suffering similar deprivations of war. The nurse in the slide is kneeling and she is bathing the eyes of a gassed patient. The nurses assuming control of British units at the base hospitals faced many adjustments. They had to learn the culture of the American Army. Then they had to learn something about France. They had to learn how to work in a British hospital setting, and this includes different languages, currency, customs, and expectations. In France, all water had to be boiled before it could be used for drinking, and for hot water for laundry, that was rare, and that happened only at fixed hours. And many times the operating rooms could accommodate four teams at once with one nurse waiting on all four tables. This photo is of a badly wounded soldier being cared for by the Johns Hopkins unit in France. The Surgeon General issued a circular letter on 14 April 1918 stating in no uncertain terms that the head nurse was second in authority only to the ward surgeon. It repeated, the head nurse is in charge. Responsibilities were shared with the ward master, but the nurse had full responsibility of the ward management. And this better defined the nurse's position It did not necessarily give them immediate status. Nurse Emma Quant from Chicago wrote, "I shall never forget my first convoy of wounded soldiers, 27 stretcher cases. Almost everyone had to have an amputation of some member of the body. A number of my patients died from exposure in the trenches because it had been about 36 hours before any aid could reach them. It was a pitiful sight to see strong, healthy young men blind or crippled for life." This slide shows the wounded of the 1st Division being cared for by field hospital personnel, and they are located in a bombed cathedral. Colonel Florence Blanchfield, who's later chief of the Army Nurse Corps in World War II, but right now she has no rank and she's in World War I, served as a surgical nurse with Base Hospital No. 27 in Angers, France. This hospital unit was with the University of Pittsburgh. They had 28 nurses assigned to 1,300 patients. She then serves as chief nurse in Camp Hospital 15 in Northern Brittany. She's one of 28 nurses tending to 15,000 wounded men. Keeping up morale was as big a job as professional duty, she was quoted to say. And while she served in World War I, she was at the ages of 33 to 35. The planning factor for a base hospital, which is 500 patient beds, was 46 nurses. So in France, each nurse was assigned to a ward that contained 50 or more patients. You may have 2 to 3 corpsmen. You may have more active convalescent patients also. The usual working day was 12 hours, except when they had patient drives. We would call those mass casualty events, where the entire staff was kept busy for 14 or 18 or more hours. This slide is Ward O of the Fracture Ward, Base Hospital No. 115 in Vichy Hospital Center, France. 86 different hotels were used as hospitals at this location. And one of the hotels was 9 stories high. It had 1,600 beds that later increased to 2,900 beds. So imagine constructing traction frames for that many patients. Another example, Base Hospital No. 10, University of Pennsylvania unit, received 1,400 patients during its first week of operation. Most of them needed surgery. Most of them had mustard gas. The 65 nurses and 18 women of the British Volunteer Aid Detachment were deeply affected by conditions of these soldiers. Another example is Base Hospital No. 20. They had a grand total of 8,700 patients admitted. Julia Stimson, again, chief nurse, Base Hospital No. 21, she described a surgical ward similar to what you see here on these two photos. Our surgical hut looks like a carpenter shop. We have 10 beds under a wooden canopy frame to which poor shattered legs of our blown to pieces men are fastened. When a leg is broken in a half a dozen places and there are several gaping infected wounds besides, it's something of a trick of carpentry and mechanics to make the poor fellows comfortable, put on extensions so the legs won't contract, and yet make it possible to irrigate the wounds. It's remarkable the way pulleys and ropes can be arranged so the men can pull themselves up with their hands to let the nurses rub their backs and change their beds. So many men come to us with terrific bed sores to add to their distress. It takes much ingenuity to take care of them. We have one man who is practically slung in hammocks, one under his shoulders, one under his lower back, and his legs in a frame with weights attached to the foot. Rubber tubes are run in and out of his thigh, his knee, and his wounds are irrigated through these tubes, which have perforations. This is a photo of Fracture Ward Base Hospital No. 41, Saint-Denis in Paris, France. In the center is the nurse with the dressing cart. Picture yourself giving care to this number of patients and with the technology and supplies that were available at that time. Nurse Emma Elizabeth Weaver joined the Army Nurse Corps, age 30, from Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and in her journal, she describes, "We are terribly busy. Patients are coming in from all fronts, many direct from the battlefield, many terribly mangled, shot to pieces, 2,200 patients to 38 nurses. You can imagine the nature of our duties. We certainly need more help. We have mustard, phosgene, and chlorine gases. All day long, from morning until night, I went from bedside to bedside doing dressings. I had an orderly assist me. He wheeled the dressing carriage and removed bandages. Strenuous days. These patients were rushed directly from the front. I always dreaded removing bandages for fear of hemorrhage. I never knew what I was going to find. There were so many missing limbs, horrible deep wounds." Now here is a clinical scene with a Red Cross nurse helping to feed a patient. And during any war, it is important to remember the contributions of Army nurses serving stateside. Sometimes the work of these nurses is overlooked. This slide shows a photo taken in Debarkation Hospital No. 2 in Fox Hills, New York City, also known General Hospital No. 41. And in the center, you see Nurse Eleanor Baylor and a patient who shared the same birthday. So they had an impromptu birthday celebration. Nurses serving in the U.S. in the cantonment hospitals at training posts had a certain set routine. At 0700, they took patients' vital signs, bathed them, got convalescent patients out of bed, changed dressings, and gave treatments. Then they prepared for the ward officer's 0900 inspection. They straightened beds, cleaned the floors, the utility rooms, the latrines, diet kitchens, refrigerators. They collected and counted soiled linen. They swept, dusted, mopped, tended stove, shoveled coal, and removed ashes. After the officers completed their rigid morning inspection, they provided nourishments. And then after dinner, the convalescent patients found recreation, the visitors came, and the nurses did their paperwork.
Probably because nurses were with the Army, but being female weren't really in the Army didn't recruit them. Yes, you heard that right. Recruiting was outsourced. It was done by the Red Cross. That let the Army administration keep women at arm's length. Now, I should probably pause and say now that while we work for DOD, these are not official comments and positions of the Department of Defense. But outsourcing recruiting made sense because the Red Cross had really good relations with the nursing profession and the nursing schools. Jane Delano had almost single-handedly created American Red Cross nursing when she united the work of the American Nurses Association, the Army Nurse Corps, and the Red Cross. And it's through her efforts that the Red Cross creates a nurse reserve from which they can mobilize nurses in the U.S. for disasters and emergencies here. And those people also sign up, or those that want to sign up saying, I'm willing to go with the Army if it needs help. And she gets 8,000 registered nurses who are already trained, they sign up saying that they're ready for duty. Showing the close Nurse Corps Red Cross links, Delano had been the superintendent of the Nurse Corps from 1909 to 12 before she goes off to the Red Cross. Now, in World War I, the Congress would quickly introduce a draft. And after some debate, they would even say that African Americans had to be drafted fairly, whatever the population percentages are. They did not say women could be drafted, although male nurses could be drafted because they were males. But because, of course, by law, they can't serve in the Nurse Corps female, they end up somewhere else in the military. So the Nurse Corps has to recruit an unknown but obviously large number of volunteers. So I'll round out Jane Delano's story. While visiting nurses in France, she stays with the Red Cross through the war. She visits nurses in France, and she gets an ear infection that progressed into mastoiditis. Earlier today, I said it was mastitis, which is slightly wrong. Now, from the mastoid, it goes... Yep, see, it's two-way learning here. From the mastoid, it goes into a brain abscess. They do surgery to irrigate. Adrian dies in April 1919. And they bury her in France. Later, they disinter her and bring her back to Arlington National Cemetery, where she has quite a nice grave. And I'll take a moment now that I'm talking about the Red Cross to go on a tangent. For those of you that are inspired to look up a World War I nurse or know of somebody, if you see that they were a Red Cross nurse or were they an Army nurse? Well, because you sign up with the Red Cross to go into the Army as a nurse, if you're an Army nurse, you have to be a Red Cross nurse. So there is 100% overlap there. But being in the Red Cross doesn't mean you're necessarily in the Army. So you can be both or you can be one. Just to keep things confusing. So how does the Army get the nurses it needs? It can't draft them. It uses the patriotic fervor that swept the country. Nurses volunteered in droves. More prosaically, to help them volunteer, There's a survey of nurses. About 98,000 nurses had graduated by 1917, but only about 66,000 were currently licensed and registered. Another 14,000 were expected to graduate each year of the 50,000 in nursing schools. So figuring out from the problem of how are we going to get the work done in the hospitals, the Army says, well, who can do it? Can we use enlisted men to do it? And they could to some degree. Can we use nurses' aides to do it? Maybe to some degree. What is the irreducible minimum that we need a registered nurse to do? This is long before the LPN, so that's not really an option. That's a nurse's aide in those days. But a lot of nursing school in those days was on-the-job training. You worked at a hospital for 2 to 3 years, generally, and you came out of that as a trained nurse, and they called it the trained nurse. So in those ways, dividing up what's a nurse's aide versus what's a nursing student is really hard. And the military is asking a fairly reasonable question, not entirely trying to dilute the quality of the RN. The nursing organizations were opposed to diluting hard-won and very recently won nursing standards. I believe in Kansas, the registration for nurses was introduced in 1913, and they really don't want to back off that level of professionalization. So despite the Army saying, hey, we'd like to use nurses' aides, despite the Red Cross saying, hey, that's fine for us, it's the nursing profession that says, don't you dare. And the Army backs away from that. So you can see where the power in nursing lies. It's not with the Army. Now, some of this recruiting is not very subtle. It's up to you or he dies. No pressure. Just do what you think is right. But as the Army comes up, you know, the Red Cross has this 8,000 deep pool of reserves. That's very nice. Thank you, Red Cross. But as the Army keeps figuring out how big it's going to be, is it going to be 4 million strong? Is it going to be even larger? Well, we need 10,000 nurses. Well, we need 20,000 nurses. Well, we need 40,000 nurses. We need 50,000 nurses. So this Red Cross pool is fine, but it's dwindling. So the Army loosens requirements, they raise the age limit, et cetera. They'll start a nursing school of their own. They decide how much enlisted men can help out. So they're really looking to find other ways to get the work done. Now, Dora Thompson's the superintendent during the war. She had joined the Nurse Corps right at the beginning and would serve until 1932, over 30 years of service. And she's the one that has to sit around the conference tables and discuss and probably debate the loosening of standards, figuring out where can we get nurses. She's working with Delano at the Red Cross, ultimately about 22,000 Army nurses. So she goes from 13%, 8,000 in the the Red Cross Reserve, 400 on active duty. So about 13% of nurses in the country. At the far end, they were looking at needing 75% of the nurses in the U.S. just to support the Army. Oh, and there was a little bitty Navy as well, but we'll leave them out of it. What she ends up with is 22,000 nurses, one in three registered active nurses in the country. So one-third of this room would have been those in the Army.
Should we number them all?
Yeah, start counting. She also works with another part of the Red Cross to recruit nurses a different way, which I'll get to in just a second. But this is the sort of thing that they did. They organized a big parade to draw attention, saying, hey, you know, we've got all these people ready. Wouldn't you like to join the war, too? You can imagine this would have been in the newspapers ahead of time for weeks as they prepare for this great big nurse march. I mentioned another route in, the organized units that the Red Cross organized. From 1914, when the war begins in Europe, some American medical personnel had gone over, mostly to get doctors with a few nurses to get surgical experience. They come back as the rock stars of surgery because they have seen and been doing way more surgery than anybody else has lately, and the most seriously wounded patients. George Kreil is one of these guys, a pioneering neurosurgeon. He writes a very high-profile article saying to civilian hospitals, hey, this, you know, the U.S. could get dragged into this in some way, so we in the medical profession should start organizing ourselves to make it easier on us as well as easier on the Army. Let's at our big medical centers get the doctors to organize themselves, and they can sign up the nurses that they're going to need. So people you know and you work easily with already, so that when the wartime stress and strain is on you, you already know how to work with that nurse. Oh, and maybe a few technicians too, but we're not going to really worry about them because the Army can find them easily. Well, the Army doesn't really have a place to put these groups. The people can be taken as individuals and put in the Medical Corps Reserve or with the nurses with the Red Cross Reserve, but there's no organization yet of units in the Army Reserve. So the Red Cross chapters around the country are asked to raise money to buy the equipment for these units and then to find some warehouse space and rent that warehouse. The University of Kansas School of Medicine signed up. There became the basis, the nucleus of Base Hospital 28. It formed during the war, so the nurses were not necessarily from KUMC. Or what, of course, becomes KUMC, but they're from the Kansas City area, Kansas, Missouri nurses. Almost all of the 100 nurses down at the bottom there are from the KC area, and they're lined up to, ready to go to war in the spring of 1918. Now I'm going to go to, I'm going to mention, got to write my notes better. The U.S. goes to war largely because of the German submarine attacking U.S. ships, and they didn't think that we could make a meaningful contribution to the war before they won the war. We were so far away, our army was so small. And in fact, the first units we get over to France are these base hospitals. That's right, the hospitals are ahead of the infantry. Half a dozen of the Red Cross organized hospitals are sent to France. There's no American troops there, so they actually go in behind the British Expeditionary Force. They get there before General Pershing and his staff do, so the hospitals really are leading the way. One of the hospitals was from Harvard, to which the young Kansas-born, Kansas-trained Lieutenant William Fitzsimmons was attached. And on the night of the 4th of September, 1917, German bombers flew over the area where he was, dropped bombs. I don't think they were aiming at his little hospital, just aiming at the ground. His tent is hit. He is mortally wounded. A couple enlisted guys are too, but Fitzsimmons is an officer. He's a doctor. He becomes the hero. Bringing it back to nurses, the Red Cross link meant that the Army could get in much more experienced nurses than it could the normal route. If you have to be under 35, et cetera, you can leave some very experienced people out. Miss Dunlop, the directress of nurses at the Pennsylvania Hospital, was unanimously selected to be in charge of the nursing department of Base Hospital 10. By this selection, the unit was most fortunate, as Miss Dunlop relied not only upon her own civil experience, but had the additional military and war experience gained while she was in charge of nurses at the American Ambulance at Noyon, France. So she's been to the war. She's seen frontline nursing. Well, not right at the front lines, but she's seen wartime nursing. And the Army can get her experience through the Red Cross back door. And I'm not going to comment on just how old she is, but I would guess she's over 35. But again, so this is the way the Army can benefit from that experience. Now, some background, you know, the war, come back to this museum and learn far more about World War I, but now that we're going to get the U.S. nurses really into the war, it started as a European war. In August 1914, a Serb terrorist shoots the heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne. Now, how many of you have heard of Austria-Hungary? Great. I'm really pleased. He was happy if a war started. Most of the countries in Europe were not afraid of a war starting. Everybody figured it would be a nice short war. Somebody would win, somebody would lose. The balance of power would be shifted 15 degrees left or right. But they're not really afraid of war, so that's what they end up with. They end up with a great big war. But since they expect a short war, medicine really isn't a priority for them. because it's going to be short. You need to keep people healthy, not sick, to be able to fight, but the wounded in a short war are not going to recover fast enough to be really useful. So medicine's not a big deal. Except that there's no quick winners in this war. The casualties in 1914 make everybody angry, so they continue fighting. They escalate the war instead of coming to the negotiating table. They escalate it geographically. Italy, Bulgaria, Romania, fighting Turkey in all different places. Virtually nobody in Europe, aside from Spain, Holland, and Switzerland, and the Scandinavian countries, can stay neutral. There's escalation in depth. As countries reach back and mobilize their industries for war, they mobilize public opinion. The enemy goes from being wrong and our opponents to being bad people to being evil. Escalating war industry in Europe means that they place orders for material over in the U.S., which is great for U.S. industry, employs a lot of Americans. But it also means that America has a financial interest in the Allies winning the war. If the Germans and their friends win the war, who's going to pay us back? Uh-oh. Escalation is in depth of weaponry. New weapons are used for advantages. Poison gas is used from April 1915. Machine guns are used to kill as many people as possible. Tanks are used to crush as many people as possible. Submarines to sink the ships that are bringing supplies to Europe. And that's really what gets the U.S. Involved, is since more ships are going carrying war materials from the U.S., we have an interest in those ships. Americans are, and there are some of them are American ships, Americans are on ships. We want to have our cake, sell munitions to Europe, and we want to eat it too. They shouldn't hurt us. The Germans sort of see this the other way around. They shouldn't hurt us. They should just stay out. And so they say, well, we're going to blockade Britain by submarines. We're going to sink every ship we can, which sort of upsets the Americans. They knew that they were going to aggravate American public opinion. They said, screw it. The Americans don't have enough military to actually win the war before we do. So by the time the U.S. enters the war, we've seen how the Europeans are doing it. We mobilize the home front by encouragement. You can stop being a hyphenated America and become all American. There's public pressure on slackers through fear and intimidation. There's laws passed that made criticizing the government an offense to put you in jail. And there's a minister who's put in jail for saying Jesus was opposed to war. That is subversive. All things German were considered suspicious, and German language schools stopped. German language newspapers were suspended. German names were changed. Sauerkraut became Liberty Cabbage. Hamburger became Salisbury Steak. The Frankfurter became the hot dog. Some of these have changed back. Some haven't. The war we're joining is trench warfare. It is not a poster war. And industrial warfare on the scale of the Western Front had lots of ways to kill you. There were shells, there were bullets, there was gas, there were bombs being dropped around. Disease is not a big killer. There are a lot of man days lost to disease, but a lot fewer deaths than in the past. Sanitation was the big lifesaver. This does not look particularly sanitary, but trust me. There's some prophylaxis like typhoid vaccine, paratyphoid, but they know about basic sanitation, you know, where you have to contain the latrines, you have to wash hands, you have to clean people when you get them out of the trenches, delouse them, keep their hair short, delouse their clothes. There are a couple new diseases from trench warfare. Trench foot comes about, and trench mouth, which was the period term for severe gingivitis because they didn't get a chance to brush their teeth. They didn't know about vitamins yet, but thanks to food preservation technology and a relatively quick distribution chain, they're mostly able to prevent nutritional problems. There are some novel diagnoses. We do find a lot of flesh and blood wounds, like the red circles, but there's also psychiatric problems, like that guy with the 1,000-yard stare. So
So at this point, it's 1917, and the United States is all in. And that means the Army's got to mobilize. That meant drafting men into service, training them for their wartime jobs, organizing them into units, and then deploying them overseas. And that meant building infrastructure. And just like in the Spanish-American War, the close proximity in which these soldiers lived and the risks of failing to practice good field sanitation techniques meant that soldiers were at risk to get sick. The Army went somewhere around 286,000 soldiers in 1917 to 4 million by the time of the armistice. And this was going to require a rapid expansion of both the Army Medical Department and the amount of available bed space in the United States to adequately support this very quickly growing army. So by this time, the Army was well versed in the fact that the conditions in the camps had a direct effect on the health of the soldiers. And the Army had adopted a public health philosophy that at this point actually tracked diseases in camps, and it did analysis of statistics, and it compared it against the disease rates both in the civilian community and in campaigns past. And everyone ensured that the soldiers had ample access to clean water, and then they educated the soldiers on how to prevent disease. But as the influenza epidemic of 1918 would present itself, which Sanders is going to talk about in depth later, there would be an even greater emphasis on public health. So, based on lessons learned, the Army knew it was going to need hospital beds, both at home and in France. And this is a nice little chart that lays out in dollars the amount the Army allocated for beds for the whole course of the war. And I can assure you that in 1918, $242 million would have been a lot of money. So there's three basic types of hospitals that exist in the United States. And to some extent, as we'll talk about in a little bit, these will carry over to France. So there were camp hospitals, base hospitals, and general hospitals. Camp hospitals tended to be hastily constructed or cantonment hospitals that were just meant to be little hospitals that supported only the camp in which they were located. They varied situationally in how they were outfitted. It wasn't unusual for a camp hospital not to be able to do surgery. They didn't do any kind of physician education at these little camp hospitals. And as you could imagine, they would refer sick patients to bigger hospitals. Sometimes these camp hospitals were hastily erected. Sometimes they were in older fixed facilities. And they could vary situationally in how they were outfitted. But and there was a little degree of difference from camp to camp. Miss Josephine Hefferman was the chief nurse of the camp hospital at Fort McDowell, which is on Angel Island in San Francisco Bay. And she said of her time working there, six nurses, epidemic of measles, about 200 patients, hospital poorly equipped, tents supplementing bed shortage, mess was indifferent, in fact, had not much to work with but willing hands and hearts. Cooperation spells the key to achievement. Nurses working overhauling beds, lockers, the kitchen got underway, and very soon our meals, though plain, were well cooked and served. One mess hall for all. Patients began to convalesce and a brighter era dawned. We lost some. Those who had complications were transferred to Letterman General Hospital. No way of performing surgical operations at Angel Island. One blessing, our small house was very comfortable. Peace and quiet reigned all around that beautiful island facing the Golden Gate of California. And that is what Fort McDowell looks like today in that particular camp hospital. So this is an example of the nurses' quarters at Camp Pike, Arkansas. And you can get a sense of sort of what these hastily built cantonment buildings would have looked like. And this is a picture inside the nurses' quarters at Camp Pike. The next bigger type of hospital was called a general hospital. And these had, as you can imagine, would have more of a regional role. They could take complicated or unusual cases, and they provided more complex surgical care. They were more academic in that they actually studied disease and the cases that they encountered, and they could be used to train junior physicians. Overseas, they could be specialized and joined with other base hospitals to form this mass of nucleus of a mammoth hospital with thousands of beds. They were logistically designed to be self-contained. At the beginning of the war, they were about 500 beds, and then they would grow to around 1,000 beds on average. And this is a picture of the Hotel Cape May, which was built in 1908. And it was a 350-room motel that the Army requisitioned to use as a base hospital, and then used it again in World War II for a similar purpose. And the Army leased it and turned it into General Hospital Number 11. And the hotel was torn down in the 90s. And then the biggest hospitals were the base hospitals. Most of the base hospitals had around 100 nurses assigned, and their capacities would often exceed 1,000 beds once the war began. And this is a picture of the base hospital at Fort Sam Houston, Texas. And the building you can see is still used today, just got remodeled, and up into the 60s, this was used for psych patients. So eventually there's going to be over 123,000 hospital beds in the United States alone. And at the time of the armistice, there would be about 92,000 patients in the United States. The Army did use civilian nurses as well as the ones that they brought on active duty. For many years prior to the war, the Army regulations allowed hiring under contract to supplement shortages. So as the Army became overwhelmed with patients, particularly during the 1918 flu epidemic, they would bring nurses on as contractors. There were certain other people that, because of their experience in civilian hospitals and their special qualifications, were used to make inspection trips to all these hastily constructed and hastily established cantonment hospitals. And then they would submit reports back to the Surgeon General discussing how the conditions were at these particular hospitals, and they offered recommendations on how they could get better. Civilian hospitals might be employed locally for about $75 a month, with a subsistence allowance of one ration per day, lodging, laundry, transportation, and $4 in lieu of traveling expenses. But the truth is, there just weren't enough trained nurses. So on January 24th, 1918, the Surgeon General advised the Secretary of War that it hadn't planned to employ anyone but graduate nurses in Army hospitals, that it had to look at establishing nurses' aides. And the Army thought that what it could do was establish a course that would last about a month, and that they could graduate nurses' aides to supplement the overworked nurses in the camps. And they prepared 1,500 nurses' aides to be shipped overseas, but the armistice occurred beforehand, and they never were employed into the Army. Before the war, there were no African-American nurses that had ever served in the Army Nurse Corps. But there were a lot of them that were anxious to join the Corps if arrangements could be made because of the relatively large amount of African-American soldiers that were in the Army. In the fall of 1918, a few African-American nurses were employed for local emergencies at Camp Pike, Arkansas, and Camp Sevier, South Carolina. And the use of African-American nurses would be limited to just these handful of few camps until the conclusion of the war, and what time they were released from active duty. One of these pioneering women was a woman by the name of Eileen Cole Stewart, and she served at Camp Sherman, Ohio. The difficulties that these nurses experienced didn't prevent them from serving with great honor. Stewart recalled, quote, "The story of the Negro nurse in World War I is not spectacular. We arrived after the armistice was signed, which alone was anticlimactic. But each of us contributed quietly and with dignity to the idea that justice demands professional equality for all qualified nurses," unquote. And in 1941, African-American nurses were allowed to join the Army permanently. The Army desegregated via executive order in 1948, and that particular executive order wouldn't be fully implemented until the Eisenhower administration. So nobody really liked this idea of using nurses' aides in World War I. They didn't think that it was a good or ideal long-term solution. But as Sanders said, you can't draft nurses. So that really only leaves two ways of getting nurses. You either recruit them or you make them. The target advanced to 50,000 nurses. And remember, there was only about 62,000 nurses in the United States, which leaves two possibilities: recruit or create. So the Army decided that it was time to establish its own school of nursing, which was named, oddly enough, the Army School of Nursing. And the school would have an additional benefit of having these students that were present to work, because remember, nursing education was largely OJT, and then that would allow them to transfer the trained nurses overseas. So they chose as their dean, Annie Warburton Goodrich, and she was from a prominent New York family that fell on hard times, so she became a nurse. And prior to the war, she had served as an administrator, and she had taught at Columbia University. And her previous assignment had been she was one of these instructors that went to these camps that were hastily created, and she inspected them and gave recommendations for improvement. So she established an office that was comprised of other prominent nurses and educators, and they got this staff of 28 clerks, and their goal was to select 10,000 students for education. And they went to work in May of 1918, and by the time of the armistice in November, they had accepted 5,267 of 10,000 applicants. And the goals of the school were to improve nursing care of the sick in the hospitals, to expand the availability of skilled nurses' care so they could shunt some folks overseas, and to standardize the delivery of nursing across the Army. The education was administered at the camp hospitals that we talked about a few minutes ago. Each school had a director and a social director who acted like a resident director and a chaperone. And there was to be 25 or 30 students at each site. The school used curriculum that was published by the National League of Nursing Education, and the Army gave the students tuition, board, lodging, laundry, textbooks, and a stipend of $15 a month. And they put them in unique navy blue uniforms, which earned them the name the Bluebirds. And this is a picture of a yearbook that they made that exists at the archives in the history office. So at the beginning of their education, the students would spend about 4 hours in class and then 6 hours on the wards each day. And after 4 months, they'd go up to 8 hours a day on the wards. And they'd do this for 2 years, and they got classes on things like caring for patients with cardiac, gastric, intestinal, infectious, and contagious diseases. And then they also had a surgical section to the course, which included work on general surgery, fractures, orthopedics, empyemas, and diseases of the eye, ear, nose, and throat. And then in the third year, they moved them out to civilian hospitals where they could learn about care of women and care of children. They adhered to some degree of military lifestyle. They drilled for an hour each day. They woke to reveille and they retreated to taps. And one of the camp commanders saw them out drilling in men's leggings, and this caused quite a stir. So he had somebody sew up short skirts that they could put over top the leggings so that they could drill with some degree of modesty. One student reported, "We jumped ditches and climbed over lumber piles. We route-stepped down a hill and marched into nice, squashy mud and out again, breathing the fresh, crisp, rare air. No wonder the girls love it. No wonder they find their uniforms getting a bit snug here and there and notice that smooth ivory arms are suddenly becoming muscular. Where in all the wide world could they find such fun as this?" The Nurse Corps received permission from the Army to actually train students overseas in France. But again, the armistice was signed before the plan could be put into motion. The school would exist until 1933. It had only graduated 937 nurses over the course of its lifetime, 28% of whom would join the Army. And we got this question in the earlier session, and the reason why was because it really wasn't until the 70s that the Army had a good mechanism of designing a contract whereby once you started in school, once you reached a certain point, you were contractually obligated to join the organization. So some of them just went to school and left. The Army would have a lot of prominent graduates, to include some prominent educators and some of our chiefs of the Corps.
This next segment will focus on military training that nurses underwent prior to going over to France. These slides show Army nurses training in the gas chambers and trenches in California. Note the white dresses, hose, and shoes. The white makeshift hair covering was to allow for easier wear of the straps of the gas mask with less hair pulling and interference in getting the mask in place quickly. In the American Expeditionary Forces, 31.5% of all casualties were due to gas exposure. Of this number, 1,200 died, the majority from mustard gas exposure, and an additional 2,800 officers and men were invalided home because of gas-related disabilities. Gas remained a serious threat to those soldiers facing it in the field. Before deploying overseas, Nurse Elizabeth Lewis wrote in a letter home, "Dear Mother, well, we are on the go all the time, and when it comes night, we are nearly dead. This is what we did today. Breakfast at 7:30 a.m., roll call 8:30 a.m. We had to make our beds between breakfast and roll call. Then at 9, we went to the Red Cross rooms. We got our cards, made out for new equipment. Then we went to another street, and we were to get measured for our street uniforms, but the tailor couldn't do it till Monday. So it was lunch, and we hurried down to the hotel and had lunch. When we got back here, we went to another place to be measured for our hospital uniforms and raincoats. Then we hurried back to the armory at 2:30 p.m., and we drilled until 4:30. Got back here at 5, went to dinner at 7. Tomorrow morning, right after roll call, we go to the store. We present the slip they gave us, and we get fitted for 2 pair of tan shoes, 1 pair of black shoes, and a pair of rubber boots. And these photos show World War I gas mask instruction for nurses and doctors going to the front in France. And these are before and after photos. And notice that the mask carriers must be worn on the chest because that's the functional length of that small box respirator. These nurses... Oh, for heaven's sakes, how do I do that? I must just have... Oh, that's my funny one. I'm going the wrong way. That's what it is. Wait. I'm smart enough to figure... No? Oh, help me. There we go. That was it. Yay! Yes. Who needs a break when you can just laugh and clap at the same time? We don't even need to stretch or anything. Violent clapping is enough. All right, I see you have taken the clicker. Okay, these nurses... these nurses are practicing litter stretcher carries and posing for photos. So not every generation took like action photos. A lot of times they did a lot of these posing photos, and then when you try to find an action photo, you're hard pressed, or it's a fake action one, you know, and you're like, oh no, that is not how we do it. But at any rate, Here, Elizabeth Lewis is still writing home, right? She has not gone overseas just yet, and she has sore arms. She said, this morning I had my third and last dose of the typhoid. They haven't been able to get that one to take on me. They said, if it doesn't take this time, I don't have to do it again. I must be immune. My arm has been swollen up. It's as hard as a rock, way down to my elbow, that makes me sick all over. The second dose was the worst. I had a headache. I was sick to my stomach. I didn't have any ambition for 4 days. It makes you sick all over. You just get to feeling really good, and it was time for the next dose. I am glad to get this over with. Now, if nurses lost their immunity papers or their shot records, they needed the treatment all over again. Some motivation for you. Both nurses, Elizabeth Lewis and Elizabeth Weaver, wrote about needing to fill out paperwork, have photos taken, have fingerprints taken, and prove they were American citizens in order to take government transportation overseas. They needed their birth certificates to prove where they were born, and they mentioned all of this red tape, and they felt this was preventing them from traveling overseas to aid in the war effort. And I would say that maybe some things never really change. This is one of my favorite photos. This is Army and Red Cross nurses doing physical training in their white uniforms during World War I. So uniforms and exercises change over time, but physical fitness and stamina continue to be job requirements of Army nurses. So this next segment will cover the forward deployment of nurses from the U.S. to France. The identification discs, or dog tags, of World War I were round, and names, ranks, and units were hand-stamped into the aluminum, and they came in a set of two, and you usually wore them around your neck with a cord. And while waiting to deploy overseas, some Army nurses took the time to study French grammar books or take language classes. Army nurses who performed satisfactorily in specialized hospitals within the U.S., and they were prepared for orthopedic, head surgery, fracture, and psychiatric cases, could be mobilized and travel overseas as cohesive units. At first, Army nurses took their oath of allegiance to the United States before departing from their homes. And then after March 1918, nurses no longer reported directly to mobilization stations. Instead, they first served on a temporary basis at cantonment hospitals in the U.S. And this ensured that they were sent on a lengthy and expensive journey overseas, and that they were professionally, physically, and otherwise suitable, and it gave them a brief period to adjust to Army nursing before encountering rigors of a combat setting. Now, the cantonment hospitals that they were serving in to prove themselves were 1,000-bed pavilion hospitals, and they had far-flung buildings, and each of the wards held between 14 and 100 patients. This is a photo of Agnes McFarland, graduate of Westchester Hospital in Pennsylvania. It isn't just me. Hooray for Agnes. And this is not an official Army photo, but you can see she has an adapted neck covering and a hat. Now, it's important to stay warm and healthy, but this, you can tell, is not an official photo. Now, after the nurses arrived in France, there were no replacements if you had worn out or lost uniforms until the chapter of the American Red Cross in England could step in and help. So when our nurse, Julia Stimson, becomes the director of the AEF and the Red Cross all at the same time, this is greatly helpful in getting uniforms and everything together. But she did need to publish a letter for her nurses to say what consisted of a proper uniform and what you could not wear. So she advised against opening your collar lower than one button below the neck. And she cautioned the nurses not to add things like collars, cuffs, spats, furs, flowers, jewelry, walking sticks, veils, or hand purses. So creativity reigned, I guess. Now that nurses have completed their military training, their red tape, their oath of allegiance to the U.S., and they have packed their bags and their trunks, they are ready to go across the ocean. These nurses now are on board the SS St. Paul. They are base hospital number 10, and they're on their way to France. It is 1917. Second in the front row is Nurse Helen Grace McClelland, and you have met her earlier, and you'll hear more about her later. Military regulations forbade Army nurses from divulging their destinations in Great Britain or France when writing letters home. Diaries were forbidden and all outgoing mail going back to the U.S. was censored. So, Nurse Elizabeth Lewis writes home, "If you should receive a card from me saying I was in New York, you will know we're getting ready to go overseas. We are about to sail. We're not allowed to say this. That's why I'm telling you now." "After you get it, don't say anything to anyone about it. It must be kept a secret. So if anyone asks you where I am, you say the last you heard, I'm still in the States. This is very important because we go over on a transport with the soldiers. You know the Germans have a wonderful spy system and we're trying to fool them. That's why we don't know when we're leaving." On board ship, the nurses lived under a constant threat of attack by German submarines, and to lessen that risk of being sighted by the enemy, the ship sailed under complete blackouts. So after dark, deck lights were never turned on, smoking was prohibited, all the portholes had to be closed before cabins could be lighted. The ships took 8 to 10 days to cross over to England and France. Some of the troop ships were converted freighters. Convoys could consist of 14 vessels. Nurses were wedged into crowded quarters, 2 to 5 to a room, and they spent most of their waking hours on deck. They were required to sleep in their clothes and life belts when crossing the submarine-infested channel waters to France. Lifeboat exercises and military drills filled their days. Nurse Weaver writes, "The abandoned ship drill happened several times a day. All the nurses, up to 500, would line up in 2 long rows in their life belts and march out on deck 2 by 2 to the boat they had been assigned. Each boat holds 29 people, including the sailor boys who row. Each nurse has a number. We're divided into squad, and you march. You do not run. There's no confusion. There's no crowding. When that bugle blows, abandon ship, everybody falls in line in short order." Colonel Florence Blanchfield, again, now no rank, World War I, later chief during World War II, describes her trip over. She was required to sleep in an all-wool swimming suit that had feet in them. And the idea was that you could better survive the frigid waters if you were attacked and your ship sunk. Now, Nurse Elizabeth Lewis had a Red Cross or Army, but she had a life-saving device, a diving suit. And this would keep you up and warm and dry for 48 hours if they were sunk. Nurse Weaver had unsinkable suits worn for any length of time in the coldest water. There is lead in the bottom to keep you in an upright position and cork in your chest to give you buoyancy. So crossing over was tense and uncomfortable, but they found it to be thrilling. Now you can be thrilling.
Okay. So what were they going to do when they got there? They're going to work in hospitals. There's a lot of advances in medicine during the war, although medicine as a whole, most of the advances are actually in surgery. And since the U.S. entered the war 2.5 years after the Europeans get started and start learning, we decide that it's smarter to learn from the guys that already figured it out rather than start back at the beginning and learn it ourselves. We didn't even send anybody to this inter-allied medical conference, but we very quickly copied the results and distributed the practices to our folks. This is the first large war after antiseptic surgery, and they're still trying to work out what is now very basic wound treatment. And this is shockingly basic. Things like actually operating for abdominal wounds becomes the standard during World War I. It is not the standard in 1914. And then you waited and you observed and you saw if they needed surgery. And they had data to back that up, bizarrely, and I can go into that later if you care. But they learned to operate more, they learned to cut away more, and just not wait. They also thought in 14 that bullet wounds would be largely antiseptic. Modern bullets will be traveling so fast, they'll be so hot, that wounds will be almost sterile. Well, the bullet might be almost sterile, but the fabric it's carrying with it is not going to be very sterile. The dirt that it may carry with it. If you fall down because you got shot, you may not end up with some dirt in you. If you get hit by a piece of shell fragment, which is going to be jagged, not nice and round like a bullet, all those other factors are true, but it's also going to pull at flesh, tear flesh in a much less clean way than a bullet will. So doctors learn to operate more, they operate sooner, they cut out more tissue, and this ends up, because of the volume of patients, where you're dealing with hundreds of thousands, the medical systems are dealing with hundreds of thousands of patients a year, they learn that it's actually better for the patient to do more surgery earlier than to do a little bit, and then a little bit, and then a little bit, and you know, just trying to stay a little bit ahead of the infection. Just do it now, do it once, and then the patient can recover from that, and the system doesn't have the patient around for months and months. Carol Dakin's solution was an antibiotic treatment. It was not an antibiotic. This is 20 years before sulfas, let alone penicillin. But it used Carol Dakin's solution, a diluted bleach buffered with boric acid, so it was it's tolerable for the body, and it's still a treatment of somewhat last resort. But it flushed this bleach boric acid solution through an open wound, and it would wash bacteria out. It would help chemically detach dead cells that the surgeon hadn't got, and it would carry those dead cells out of the body. So it's sort of like having a dribbler hose, and you can sort of see holes in these tubes with bleach being flushed through it. Whole wards of these post-operative surgery wards would smell of bleach. You can imagine what that was like. Or you can not imagine what it was like. You can see the holes in the tubing really, really well. But Carol Dakin's solution turns out to be a flash in the pan. If you start, the process had good surgery, cleaning the wound with Carol Dakin's solution. They would check slides for bacteria count, and only when the slides were coming back clean would they sew the wound up. Well, if you have three of those four, if you don't use the wound flushing, you're still well off. So they realized after the war that the Carol Dakin solution was faulty. So the U.S. official history ignores that and says that good surgery is really the key to preventing gangrene. Blood transfusion receives its first major test in the war. Blood groups are not yet known. Refrigerators are not very portable, so blood banking is basically impossible. There is some arm-to-arm transfusion. It's more common to have this sort of arm-to-bottle-to-arm transfusion. Shock received a lot of attention. Replacing blood was very problematic. Tourniquets were controversial. But warming the patient was not either intellectually controversial or practically hard. They learned to elevate the feet to keep the blood around the heart and the head. This chamber on the left, chamber on the left is a warming chamber. It's a box they put over you. They would put blankets on top of that with blankets draped down to the floor, and they would have candles or alcohol burners underneath so that you warmed up. It doesn't hurt. Yeah. And this is the state of the art. This is something they actually learned during the war. And you can see some of the transfusion apparatus is over there on the right. They learn about putting fluid replacement. They're using Ringer's lactate instead of blood or plasma. They don't have plasma yet. And it takes years to determine the physiology of shock and what the best treatments were, but they're going on empirical evidence and they're not waiting for anything better. They've got patients to treat. So this chart is British, and I deliberately picked a British example because this is a time when we learned from them. They learned that, oh my gosh, we got to prophylactically treat for tetanus. And pretty soon they started, anybody that was wounded, they started giving them a tetanus shot. We learned this from them. We never have the left side of the chart problem. Some of the stuff we do is actually really advanced. There's not just cranial neurosurgery, but nerve grafting. This is not common. I don't want to portray them as being on the everything being up to date. But there were, you know, people were doing this. Something else we learned, this is pretty much the only slide you see for this whole topic, is war psychiatry. We had learned from the Allies that about shell shock. We thought conceptually that it was an underlying weakness that you could screen for, and that would be great if you could, you know, administer people a test and see who is prone to break down from combat and say, no, you don't go to the war. That would be great. That would be great for the individual, and it would be great for the military that doesn't have the problem in the field. Well, the screening test they had was worthless. So they end up with problems over in France, and they say, well, okay, we've got this problem. Let's deal with it. Our theory was wrong, but let's deal with the facts we've got. They train a psychiatrist, limited amount of training, but the best they could, and they put one per combat division. He saw all suspected mental patients. So if you were trying to fake it, he saw you, and he it was his job to try and get you out from faking it. But if you were really having psychological problems from combat, they started treating you close to the front lines so that you wouldn't fix the symptoms by over-evacuating the patient. They treated you as soon as possible so that you got help as soon as possible, but also if you were just tired, hungry, cold, etc., then you got help sooner and you could return to duty sooner. And they treated you with the expectation that you're going to return to duty, because support is a lot of getting people back. And that, with some rest and humanity, most men would recover and return to duty in combat. The worst cases were evacuated to specialty hospitals in the rear for specialized treatment. You know, a lot of these people can recover and return to duty, but there are those that can't, and we have to provide properly for those. So there's a couple of specialty psych hospitals. They're called neurology hospitals, partly because they don't want to fix the symptoms and say, oh, it's a nuts hospital, so they're going to call it a neurology hospital, and partly because that's how they conceptualize the problem. It is not simply a behavioral health problem. To them, with shell shock of being shook up, there is a physiological aspect to this too, a neurological aspect. And we're coming actually back to that when you think of TBI and the behavioral problems coming out of being shook up. Maybe they weren't so wrong. And for the nurses, the Army would pick nurses to go to these psych hospitals. Many of them had backgrounds in civilian psych nursing, but they also provided more male corpsmen attendants because they needed somebody strong enough to restrain the psychotic patients. Gas was another new experience for the military. We suffered disproportionately heavily because we walk into 1917, 1918, a very sophisticated chemical battlefield with no experience. The Europeans had it grow on them gradually. Phosgene was the most lethal agent commonly used against the AEF, but more percentage gas casualties were from mustard gas. Lower lethality, but it caused extensive blistering and could keep a man in the hospital for months. And it, only recently have there any treatment other than just waiting it out been developed. There were casualties that were called gas fright. Guys were trained that this gas stuff is really bad, it can kill you, you have to be able to get your mask on in a few seconds. This gas stuff is really bad, you have to be able to get your mask on. So they're going forward, they're going into action, they smell something funny, and they think, ah, gas, and they run away. Or they're malingering. They think, what's the best way to get out of combat? Pretend I've been gassed. They can't, there's no outward sign that I've been gassed, so at least I'll be back to the doctors before they can send me back to the front. And they learned some tricks to weed out guys like that. But for mustard, decontamination was the key, followed by preventing infections once the blisters pop. Patient care was much more intensive for the nurses than for the doctors. For the different treatment for different gases, with phosgene, with mustard it was decontamination. With phosgene, it's rest and oxygen supplementation. They created gas teams of one doctor, two nurses, and two enlisted guys with extra oxygen cylinders and some tubing to go up forward. This is before we get ventilators. They get a training course, they get this equipment, they go up to the front to treat the large volumes of patients. This is probably a Red Cross nurse in the circumstances. This picture is from early August of 1918, before there's a lot of Army hospitals to go to the front, which leads me back to an earlier tangent. It takes a trained historian to go back to tangents. I talked about Red Cross nurses versus Army nurses earlier, okay? You could be a pure Red Cross nurse and still be over in France. You didn't have to be an Army nurse to be in France. The Red Cross had personnel in France. It ran hospitals. It ran clinics that helped French civilians. There was talk in October of 1918 about the Army taking over 2,500 personnel from the Red Cross because, quote, the American Red Cross personnel serving with the armies are performing the same duties as the medical department of the Army. That doesn't actually happen, but I think she's a Red Cross nurse working with the Army. Trench foot was a new problem. It is not a huge problem for the U.S. Again, we learn from the Allies, even if you're going to be living in the mud, even if your feet are going to be cold for long periods of time, take your boots off once a day, twice a day. Massage your feet. Make sure you've got some blood flow. Change your socks when you can. Send up fresh socks with the food every day and send stinky ones back. So, you know, that patient is an American patient, but he is very much the exception. But the bulk of the casualties that the U.S. faced, the medical department faced, were what we expected. People who were hit by a physical missile, shell, fragment, bullets. As I mentioned, the state of the art in surgery in the U.S. Advanced. A very large percentage of patients that arrive in a hospital would survive. Now, that's not to say that everybody that gets hit is going to do well. You have people that are killed outright. You have people that die between being hit and getting to a hospital, but 92% of the people that arrived alive at a hospital survived the hospitalization. And with this broken bone, I think we'll take a break. The military organizes medical care through a chain of evacuation from point of wounding back through successive medical care to a hospital in the rear. And it's because it's different from civilian medicine. The environment is not safe. If a car accident, there's not likely to be a lot of people shooting and continuing to make it hard to get an injured person away from an auto wreck or a tractor accident or something, whatever. Whereas the military has to expect that it is not going to be easy to get the patient back the first 100 yards or the next 1,000 yards or even a few miles. So they have to provide care further forward because it's not going to be necessarily quick to get them to a hospital, and also provide care along the way. So the Army pays a lot of attention to pushing care forward, which makes it a big difference for the nurses in World War I, but also for having care at various different echelons. Now, there's no quiz on the details of this, which is good, because I don't remember them either. But my point is that there is care at every echelon. Every tactical echelon, there's going to be some guys there to at least put on a bandage, check the bandages, prioritize who needs to be on the next ambulance that can get back. And it's what the military is doing here is getting patients away from the front line so that the combat commanders can focus on their main job, which is pushing the enemy back instead of worrying and stopping thing, the combat to take care of the wounded. Now, that does not mean that the care forward is very fancy care. The aid man was issued bandages, iodine. Bandages and iodine, yeah. They could, under a physician's supervision, they could give morphine and anti-tetanus serum. And that's really it. That is the standard of care up front. And this is a paper wrapper over a gauze bandage. So you know that in the mud that that's going to stay nice and tidy and dry. So the aid man's equipment is this, 10 bandages and one armband to say that please don't target him specifically. And this is the fake version. Troops in France hardly ever wore these hats, and only an idiot would be standing around outside a trench where there's already been somebody wounded, saying, "Look, pick him up gently, pick him up gently." So, but while this is laughable in its way, I think it's showing us that the American public was interested in what trench warfare was like, and the Army was interested in showing them that we are going to be taking care of your wounded. Now, from the front lines, a stretcher bearer would haul the wounded back to an aid station where the doctor did a little bit. And typically, you would have a second, could well have a second phase of stretcher evacuation back from an aid station to where the ambulances could go. The ambulances often can't go very far forward. They're horse-drawn ambulances. They may be Model Ts. Which is, you know, state of the art in 1917, 1918. But that's not necessarily going to be the case. You may have to haul them by brute force. At the aid station, things are not necessarily very advanced. The doctor's armamentarium is more bandages, tourniquets, morphine, strychnine, and some more anti-tetanus serum. Now, those ambulances, not very fancy. When you consider that they're going to be going over cobblestone roads, not a smooth tarmac autumn road, the hard tires that they had, the pretty creaky springs, it is not a gentle ride for the patients in the back. And these ambulances are going to be competing for space. They can't turn on blue lights and flash down the road and pass all the traffic. During the Meuse-Argonne offensive late in the war, patients could be delayed 10 or more hours in an ambulance. And that's after the delay of getting them from where they're wounded back to an aid station, back to where the ambulance can pick them up. So you could be looking at 50 to 60 hours before a patient gets to an operating room. And that does not bode well for them in operations. Their golden hour didn't exist. They didn't have any data for it. They would have loved to do it if they could have. They did it when they evacuated as quickly as they could, but there were an awful lot of outside constraints that stopped them having it. And you also don't get much paramedic care on the way. Oh, and I mentioned the muddy roads. Yeah, the roads could be a problem too. So you've put all that effort into getting back to a hospital. We're also pushing the hospitals forward. So what kind of hospitals are they? Well, there are three kinds of hospitals in the zone of the armies, above the line there, mostly for the wounded. If you're sick in the zone of the up front, you would go to a field hospital, you'd go to an evac hospital. If you're sick in the rear, you go to a camp hospital and possibly to a base hospital. But the Army is focusing more on the wounded, probably because the wounded are a higher priority. Between the two, you have hospital trains. World War I is when triage enters the English language. It's a French word for sorting, trying to turn these great big gaggles of patients into neat rows. Did I mention neat rows? Yes, I did. Now, I want to talk about triage priorities, because the armies that go to war in World War I have an army-centric triage priority. The patients that are going to return to duty are the first priority. So the lightly wounded, that are going to return, you know, a few days or a few weeks. They're going to be back in action and helping win the war. That's the priority. Not the guy. It's not keeping alive everybody you can. That changes. For the U.S., we actually change that before we go into action. And I think it's realizing that they're answering to a mass army of the and having to maintain the support of the American public. This is not a regular army of guys who have volunteered to go off and live their lives in camp at Fort Dusty and Fort Nowhere and have very little contact with much less contact with the civilian world. These are guys 18 to 30, or 21 to 30 in the first draft, 18 to 40 in the second draft, who have families, many of them, and they are civilians in uniform, and the government has to explain to their families, yes, we're going to take care of them as best we can. And as best we can was understood. So instead of the lightly wounded getting first treatment, they go to the end of the line when time is available. At the field hospital is the first place for significant medical treatment. Every infantry division had four of them, and it often shuffled personnel and equipment among the four so that one was surgical, one was for gas patients, one was for sick, and one was spare to move forward or to augment somewhere else. They're ideally located alongside a main road, maybe 2 to 4 miles behind the front line. That's still within artillery range. They might work in buildings, they might work in huts, they might work in tents like this. They did whatever they could. But they are not fancy. A 216-bed field hospital could put all of its equipment in 8 trucks. So we're not dealing with a lot of ICU equipment here. They don't even have an X-ray machine. And that's because their role is not to really hospitalize a patient. They're called a hospital, but they're mostly there to prepare him for further evacuation. They will intervene surgically if they have to. They're not really equipped for it or optimized for it. But they will. The only guys they'll keep are if you're going to return within about 3 days. So if you got, you know, you're a little bit sick, you've twisted your ankle, or you're very lightly wounded. But anybody else, they send somewhere else. Inside the field hospital, they had to take them in, clean them off from the mud and yuck of the trenches. A little yuckier than most civilian life. I think these are leaning away from the head so that when they wash the patient off, the water does not run up their noses. But since the front line had been stable for years, a lot of the times the hospitals are operating in buildings. But because these are forward, women are not intended to be permanently in the field hospitals. They may be, they're also part of the infantry division. So the field hospitals are. So if you assign women to a field hospital, you have just made them part of an infantry division, which is something we don't really do now. But nurses do turn up here in specialty teams. These 5 or 6 person teams were a new thing that would move specialized healthcare providers forward on the battlefield, shock teams, surgical teams, gas teams, orthopedic teams. And that's really putting women in the danger zone. And the women volunteered for this rather than just remain in the rear when it was safer. Julia Stimson said that it was the goal and prize for which every nurse longed, maybe. Certainly there were plenty of volunteers for it. Shock teams were specially trained in pre-op resuscitation. In that world when IV fluids were new and rare, those transfusions were mostly done by specialty teams. I already touched on gas teams. Surgical teams were mostly general surgery rather than any kind of specialty surgery. There wasn't a lot of medical specialization yet. There was only one board, ophthalmology, in 1914. There are a few neurosurgery teams late in the war, but it's mostly general surgery. The teams would have 2 surgeons, an anesthetist, a doctor or a nurse, just depending what was available, 2 scrub nurses, and 2 enlisted men. Okay, there are no nurses in this picture, but I wanted to show a forward operating room. you know, they're using a house. They are fairly sterile. I'm sure they washed their hands. They're not masked. But, you know, they are doing surgery much further forward than they would have otherwise. Surgical capability is, of course, more than just surgeons. To get the Army also had to provide some radiology capability. So this mobile surgical unit that the Army creates is really an X-ray truck. It has no surgical capability itself. It facilitates the surgery. One driver, one X-ray machine operator, and then a hastily trained radiologist to look at the film. So it's actually easier to organize the team with surgeons on it than it is to build and maintain and get this equipment forward. But there's only so much you could augment a field hospital. So since the data said early surgery saves lives, they adopt a French unit, the Ambulance Chirurgicale Automobile, which being Americans, they call a mobile hospital because you can actually say that. Here's the first one training outside a city somewhere in France. Who said censorship was dead. These are supposed to go as far forward as the division triage hospital. So they're up with the field hospitals. They take the non-transportable patients, the guys that are going to die if you put them in a second ambulance ride back. These are the forerunners of the MASH, but they don't have helicopters to fly the patients in, and they also don't have helicopters to fly a patient out. So that post-operative patient has to be in good enough condition to handle an ambulance ride in those sorts of ambulances. So in effect, once you take a patient onto the ward, a post-op patient, he's gonna be in that hospital and that hospital is gonna be immobile for 7 to 15 days. So that's another planning factor they had to keep in mind. I mentioned they adopted this from the French. They bought French equipment. It came with French signs on the side. It came with French instruction manuals and supply tables that they sat down and translated into English so they could understand what to do with this new equipment. It had two trucks. One had the sterilizer and one had the X-ray unit. Now, moving a hospital is a lot easier when all you have to do is move some bed frames, move some linen, pillows and blankets, and move a couple of chests of OR equipment. There are no ventilators to move. There are no infusion pumps to move. There's no laboratory to move. It's really a lot simpler in those days. This is a mobile hospital deployed. It looks a lot like it did outside a French city not to be named. The difference, you know, they're as far forward as the field hospitals, but they have nurses baked into the unit. They are integral to the unit. Not a haphazardly attached team. So from July of 1918 until the end of the year, nurses were as close to the fighting, were close to the fighting, at least from the medical point of view. I don't think the infantry would have said that the hospitals were close to the fighting, but from the doctor's point of view, they were. And that's not because the Army is interested in women equality or making doing nice things for nurses. It's because nurses are needed up close to the fighting to keep people alive. That's the bottom line for the Army, and they say, well, we wanted to protect women from that, but we can't, so go forward. Now, these hospitals had 120 beds, sometimes more, and a total of 20 nurses. So when you subtract the operating room nurses, when you subtract the anesthesia nurses, those ward nurses were really pretty hard worked. After another ambulance ride, you get to the evacuation hospital, 8 to 10 miles from the front. That's probably out of shelling range. There's a peacetime formed this unit in the Army. It did not have nurses then because there were going to be no nurses forward of the base hospitals. In wartime, they say nursing makes a real difference. We're going to push the nurses into these evac hospitals too. They could work in canvas. They could work in hard buildings. They could work in something in between like this floored tent. But they're getting the medium priority medium acuity patients. The field hospitals could take the really low acuity patients. The mobile hospital would take the high acuity patients, and the evac hospitals got the guys in between. So they get, the Army does not have enough hospitals in France, so it expands these up to 1,000 beds each. It adds the nurses, and they have to move around a lot because they are in short supply. Evac 5, seen here after the fighting was over, was involved in 3 battles in July and August, 2 in September, and then 2 in October, November. They bounce all over the front. In September, October, November, 3 months, they admit over 15,000 patients. That's 270 a day for every day. So if the days they're closed and moving around between battles, so that's easily up over 300 patients a day when they're actually functioning. Internally, the evac hospitals and base hospitals, Rich will talk more about, they organize specialty teams internally, orthopedic teams, radiology teams, shock teams that would be working 12-hour shifts. And the ortho teams were really splint teams. They would work on the wards, they would scrub so they could go into the OR and take over once the surgeons had finished so the surgeons could move on to the next patient. Elizabeth Lewis, you saw earlier, she worked at EVAC 15, among others. She wrote home, "I've had the privilege of being with the nearest evacuation hospital to the lines. This is the nearest nurses have ever been to the front." That's what they told her. I didn't want to tell you while the war was on, for I knew you would worry. I will tell you now, though. We had to have our gas masks with us all the time, and there were a few nights I wore my helmet back and forth to midnight lunch. When you see the shells whizzing all around you, that is as near as the front as I want to get. I must admit, I was crazy to get near the front, but I've had all my desires satisfied here. Fortunately, no one was injured at the hospital, but in the village a few yards from us, 2 men were injured one day, and in the city, the Germans were always throwing over gas shells. And I tell you, this has been quite an exciting place. Tell Papa that living in these evacuation hospitals at the front is camping in the Maine woods scun 100 ways. In Maine woods, you can cut enough wood to keep warm, but over here, you can't cut any trees down. So from the evac hospitals, they put them as close to a railway line as they could to move out large quantities of patients, to keep beds empty up forwards for the next patients that would come in. We got hospital trains from the British and French, theoretically 360 beds each, although there were ways to cram more and more patients on them. Now, for a mere 360 patients, you got 2 or 3 doctors, 3 or 4 nurses, and 36 enlisted guys, so quite a workload. Early in the Meuse-Argonne campaign, there were not enough forward hospitals for the large number of patients, and they figured out, well, the place we have surgical capability is back at the base hospital, so let's put the lightly wounded on a train and cross our fingers and see what that does. Well, when you consider that the guy had already been a number of hours post-wounding before he gets to a railway train, and then he can be 1 to 3 days delayed on the railway train because they get shunted aside for something that's higher priority. A lot of patients got back to those base hospitals with pretty significant infections or shock or had just died on the way. That wasn't what the Army wanted, but you know, it was the best they could do in the circumstances, and they take a lot of steps during the Meuse-Argonne to provide more forward surgical care. 360 patients on one train, you can imagine how much labor was involved. You don't see any nurses bothering to do that. They're all busy on the wards, I'm sure. They had an operating table for emergencies. I have no idea how many times it was used. And something camp hospitals now.
So Sanders just got done telling you about these hospitals that were forward deployed. They could pick up and move. They moved with the maneuver units, and they were very proactive. The hospitals that we're talking about now are the fixed facilities. They occupy places all over the French countryside, and their jobs are to support the soldiers while they're in the rear, and then to accept these patients that are moving backwards from the front. And just like before, the first hospitals that we encounter are the little camp hospitals, 300 beds. They were in these rudimentary wooden buildings. There were about 100 of them in France. And their job was just to provide regional support to these little camps. They resided pretty far back from the front areas, and they really didn't do a whole lot in the way of things like surgery. We've talked quite a bit about Florence Blanchfield. She was our corps chief in World War II, presided over 56,000 nurses. She's the only Army nurse that is memorialized in a hospital now, Florence A. Blanchfield Army Community Hospital at Fort Campbell. And she was one of the nurses in Camp Hospital number 31. Here's a picture of Camp Hospital 31. It occupied the site of what was a formerly an old French artillery training camp. They used about 12 buildings, and each of the buildings had about 60 beds capacity. Unfortunately, one of the things that had to be dealt with at these camps are the critters that soldiers brought back from the lines. So the patients would have to undergo a delousing process before they could report to the wards. And also, of course, clothing and bedding had to be deloused. And this is a picture of a prisoner of war whose job it was to delouse bedding in one of the camps in a large steam sterilizer. So one of the things that you'll find impressive if you study these nurses long enough is the love that they had for the soldiers that they took care of and the attention to detail that they had and the desire that they had to make the best of everything. And this is a picture of one of the wards of Camp Hospital number 68. And you could see that they scrounged up a lot of stuff to decorate for the holidays. In the center of the room behind the stove, you can see a Christmas tree. And then you can see the foliage in the rafters and the streamers and the American flag. So just like in the States, the next thing we had is these really big base hospitals. The base hospitals were 1,000 to 2,000 beds. They were the largest of the hospitals in the AEF, and they were far behind the lines. Generally speaking, they were in very safe locations. And it was here that the specialty care was delivered and that sick and wounded soldiers convalesced for the long term. They had specialty wards, they had specialty physicians. There were 128 base hospitals that operated independently, and there were a number of other ones, 91 of them in fact, that were part of hospital centers, which were large coalesced groups of based hospitals that we're gonna talk about in a sec. They could exist in hastily constructed buildings, or ideally they could be in a very large school or pre-existing hospital. But the problem was is at this point in the war, a lot of the better buildings are already occupied by the French, or some of the buildings that were in better shape were used to house refugees. So a lot of these buildings were in horrible shape. They didn't have heating, they didn't have plumbing, and they were in various states of disarray. So oftentimes, the Army had to build onto them, and then they had to remodel them in order to make them work. This is an example of the headquarters that was on base hospital number 101. And then additionally, they constructed these prefabricated wood buildings. Bessie Baker, the chief nurse of base hospital 101, would write, "Day by day, our wards filled up rapidly with soldiers. At the same time, the nurses began to fall ill in large numbers. We started an 8-hour day, but with many patients on the wards and sick nurses in the infirmary, the periods spent on duty became as many hours as one could stand." And this is an example of what an operating room looked like at base hospital number 101. And there's about 100 nurses assigned to each of these base hospitals, and these are the nurses of Base Hospital 101. So like I said, the Army just couldn't find that many buildings to use that were in good enough shape that they could be used for a hospital, so they had to build them. And originally, the plans called for enduring hospitals that have all the amenities that you would find in the United States. But however, the planners very quickly realized that these were too elaborate, they were too expensive, and they would take too long to create. So instead, they came up with this idea of creating these very quickly built wooden building cantonment hospital, and they came up with a standardized plan that they called a Type A base hospital. And that's what you see here. And this plan called for 20 wards that could house 50 patients each. And then on the periphery, they would have another 1,000 beds that were in tents. And you could take the soldiers who no longer required as intensive inpatient stays that were convalescing and move them out to the tents. Or you could take patients and overflow them to the tents if you were in the midst of a surge. And this is a schematic that you would see for one of the wards on one of these Type A base hospitals that had 60 beds in it. So today, if a soldier is wounded in Afghanistan, he or she's going to be quickly flown via helicopter to a surgical hospital. And from there, they'll get whatever stabilizing surgery they need. And usually within 24 hours, they'll be flown to Germany to Landstuhl Army Medical Center. They'll stay in Landstuhl for a day or two, and then they'll be flown to one of the major medical centers that we have in the United States, like Walter Reed or Brook Army Medical Center. And they'll literally wake up from their wounds 5 or 6 days later when they're extubated with their loved ones present in the States. But things weren't like that then. So the Army had to figure out what to do with all of these wounded soldiers that couldn't go back to the United States. Now, Sanders told you before about how the Atlantic Ocean was vigorously patrolled by U-boats, so it was dangerous to send the patients back. If they were sick, they might not even survive the journey. So the Army had to come up with a concept of how you were going to house thousands and thousands of soldiers in France until either they were well enough to go back to their units or they required to go back to the States because there's just no way they could be convalesced. And generally speaking, the cutoff was 4 months. If a wounded soldier could go back to duty within 4 months at time of injury, if that was what they thought that would happen, then they would keep them in France. If after some time had passed and they thought it was going to take longer than 4 months to convalesce them, they'd try to move them back to the States. So the way that they did this was they clustered base hospitals. And they would combine as many as 10 base hospitals into hospital centers that had as many as 20,000 beds. And that would provide a lot of advantages. For one, they could specialize. So certain units were specially equipped for treatment of surgical patients or orthopedic patients or eye patients. And then this allowed the Army to be able to share staff from hospital to hospital. And these essentially became freestanding little cities that had 20,000 beds each in them. The location for the hospital centers were strategically selected. Ideally, they would be near major roads or railways. They had to have access to potable water, sewage, electric. And then they were going to need a lot of stuff just to keep them going. They were going to need warehouses, garages, ice plants, bakeries, post offices, fire engines, chapels, laboratories, and morgues. Sometimes they were forced to construct new buildings, and sometimes they were just able to use the pre-existing French ones. So by the time the armistice came around in November of 1918, there would be 143,000 of these beds located in just these hospital centers. And they could peak out at 282,000 beds if there was an emergency. Ultimately, there'd be 22 hospital centers. And the largest one of these was established at Mev, which is in central France. And it consisted of 9 hospitals, and this hospital center had 25,000 beds alone. The construction started in February in 1918, but by the time they started occupying it in the July of 1918, because they were having problems with the contractors, because they were having problems getting supplies, construction supplies, they only had like 7 buildings done. And the 7 buildings didn't have anything but a roof. They didn't have any windows. They didn't have any plumbing. They didn't have any electricity. And they just fell in and they started taking care of the patients in that state. These are the staff of Base Hospital 50. Base Hospital 50 was one of the 10 base hospitals that made up the hospital center in Mev. This is a modern day picture of Google Earth, and the hospital actually was located in the fields on either side of this road in between these two buildings. And like all of these hospitals in France, they're all gone now. They were all, you've seen the pictures, they weren't made to last a long time. And Sanders actually got a call from an archaeologist who is looking at doing some digging in some of these sites in France to see if there's anything remaining from some of these hospitals. The amount of support that was required was mammoth. So at the Mev Hospital Center, there were all of these medical units, but there were 5 engineer units, 7 supply units. There were also units whose job was just to provide manual labor. This is a picture of some of the overflow tents that were at the hospital center at Mev. So Sanders talked about this for just a minute, and as you recall, there were affiliated university hospitals, and KU has its own place in the history of World War I in that it supported one of these base hospitals. In the spring of 1917, the University of Kansas agreed to charter a base hospital to be sent to France. Dr. John Binney and Dr. Lindsay Milne organized the physicians to participate. Binney was a world-renowned surgeon, and he assumed the role of commander, while Milne was the second in command. The nurses and medics were recruited from the Kansas City area. They assembled at Fort McPherson, Georgia, in June of 1918, and they were designated as Base Hospital Number 28. And they embarked from Camp Merritt, New Jersey, on the SS Megantic, and the unit's nurses moved separately. Once they arrived in France, they became part of one of these really large hospital centers, the hospital center at Limoges, which was a town in the central western portion of the country. They fell in on partially constructed buildings very similar to what I just mentioned, as well as a seminary that was under construction. And the seminary provided some living quarters as well as a hospital space, and they also built these temporary wood structures around it. Dr. Peterson did a really great job writing up a history of this unit. So if you Google Base Hospital Number 28, you'll find a nice web piece that Dr. Peterson did if you'd like to learn more about it. They had a bed capacity at the end of 2,965 beds. They admitted 9,954 patients over the course of the war. And they stayed until February in 1919, and they left France to come back here to Kansas in April of 1919.
Looking at some of those overflow beds at the tents, a lot of that was for the flu. Now, The pandemic flu was a bad thing. I'll go into more detail. It may have started an Army post over in Kansas. Certainly the Army helped spread it around the country. The war helped spread it around the country. And I think the crowding that the Army put people in, you saw some of the barracks scenes that Colonel Pryor had earlier, putting so many people together let the virus mutate faster and become more lethal. The war effort, I mentioned, Philadelphia, for instance, had a victory loan parade to raise money for the war effort. The mayor said, we need to have this parade. His medical advisors said, there's a flu going around. And the mayor said, no, we need to sell bonds. And they sold their bonds. And then they had a lot of dead people as a result. Now, you know, the flu may well have hit Philadelphia a little slower, but just as lethally anyway. But you can certainly say that the war effort didn't help things. The Army had over 1 million admissions. That's over one quarter of the Army admitted for respiratory diseases per year. Now, part of that is, you know, they admitted people to hospital lower acuity than we do today. But this is also an undercount. If the hospital was full and you couldn't get admitted to the hospital, you didn't get counted. If you were admitted for something else and then you developed flu, you weren't a flu patient. That's just how they kept the books. I don't know how they keep the books today, but so this is an undercount, and it's still 25% of the military or the Army. The 44,000 deaths cited here is an undercount as well. The currently accepted number is around 53,000. Now, that's bad enough. But when you remember that 20 to 100 million people died around the world, it's not that bad. Not that bad. And you also set it against a U.S. population of roughly 100 million at this point. Now, this rate is also Army-wide. The flu rate is lower in Europe largely because there's a mild flu in the midsummer that probably boosted a lot of people's immune systems. So the flu rate is actually substantially higher in the States. The current thinking is that about three quarters of the population was naturally immune to the flu anyway. So this flu infected everybody who could get it and killed a bunch of them. So that was statistics. This is another way to look at it. The few medical people around had to deal with lots and lots and lots of patients. And they didn't have a lot of tools. At Camp Grant, Illinois, a little west of Chicago, until September of 1918, the camp had a good health record. By mid-September, they knew a bad flu was around, so the camp commander took measures, including a nearly total quarantine. But the Army had sent a batch of officers in from Camp Devens, Massachusetts, and Camp Grant had a shortage of buildings, so he scattered them around to fit them in where he could. The next day, 108 flu patients who'd already been incubating it, obviously. So they go to the hospital, gauze masks are applied all over. Their two units were isolated from the rest of the camp, and he banned public gatherings. You know, no movies, no YMCA. You have your meal, you go, and you go back to your barracks. But the virus had arrived, every unit on post had flu. Hospital admissions went from 108 to 194, to 371, to 492, to 711. In six days, the hospital went from 10 patients in beds to 4,102 patients in beds. Barracks were converted into wards, healthy soldiers were moved out into tents, training stopped, the soldiers were assigned to work in the hospital to help. They were filled mattresses, they unloaded supplies, the medical staff was falling sick, 11 out of 81 doctors were sick. There were so many patients that medical supplies and sheets and blankets ran short. They threw a note over the fence to the Red Cross saying, please send help. They go to Chicago and get more sheets and blankets and such. They're willing to try anything, and the commander says, yes, let's hire some black nurses to work here, but they have to wait until they get segregated quarters built, because that's the law, That's the law. So they have to build the segregated quarters before the black nurses can turn up. They get family members coming who've gotten a telegram or a telephone call that their soldier boy was sick. They try to get special care for their family member. Congressmen are sending a telegram saying, I hear so-and-so is sick, please tell me, which really helps because nothing helps like patient care like stopping to do paperwork. The camp commander was willing to, he was doing everything he could. He had said, you know, let's set up the quarantine measures ahead of time, figure out the quarantine measures ahead of time. He signed whatever orders the doctors wanted him to sign, but it wasn't working. One day, almost 2,000 men reported sick. And they couldn't keep up with converting barracks into wards. They were gargling with germicides twice a day. They were spraying germicides into noses and mouths. Doctors were so tired that their handwriting was getting even worse. So they said, you have to type the patient names on forms because we do not want to inform the wrong family that somebody is sick or dead. 15 days into Camp Grant's war with the flu, the commander gets his daily medical briefing. 500 men have died, thousands more are currently sick and dying. And the commander says thank you to his doctor. You may leave now. And he also sends everybody else out of the headquarters building and he shoots himself. Yeah. So the flu kills a lot of people. The comorbidity adds another 20,000 or so. So as long as the nurse practitioners haven't given out too many doses of antibiotics for case things that aren't really sick, we should have some antibiotics for the next flu, and we should have some antivirals. I hope so. But they don't have drugs to give flu patients, nothing useful. I mean, they do all this stuff. They squirt sprays, they gargle enemas, emetics, VapoRub. One nurse tried giving patients honey. One corporal gave patients whiskey and aspirin. You know, nothing's really useful. They do develop some pneumonia vaccines, which are actually quite useful against pneumonia. They try some other stuff, which is, well, it may have helped morale, but it certainly wasn't actually stopping disease. General Pershing cables back from France, you know, we've got flu here too, I need nurses. He doesn't ask for doctors, he says, I want nurses. And this is what the mortality curve looked like. Obviously the old and the young were dying from it, but one quirk of the virus was that it hit the young and healthy, which by the way is the army, hard too. Their immune systems overreacted and actually flooded their lungs. Temperatures would rise to 105 or 106. People bled from all kinds of places that you can imagine. They would cough up material that looked like tomato puree, but it was part of their lung. And some people were dying within 24 hours, so that's obviously a fulminating flu. It's not pneumonia. The scope, speed, and lethality was scary. Scared doctors. A team of leading pathologists went to Camp Devens, which was an early epicenter, and they wondered if there is a new plague loose. We were at once struck by the cyanosis which most of the patients exhibited. One could pick out the infected men among those standing about by the color of their faces. We went to the morgue and saw a large number of bodies piled up waiting to be examined. In one after another of them, when the chests were opened, we saw a large amount of bloody fluid in the pleural cavities, and in cutting open the lungs, there were large areas of wet hemorrhagic consolidations. This is bad. This is another way to look at bad. But this is the standard of care. Don't get sick. Prevent the flu as best you can. And if you do get sick, hope for some nursing, because warmth and fluids and rest, nurse-centric supportive therapies are about all they can do. They cubicled beds with sheets to make it harder for the germs to spread. They would put the beds head to foot so that at least there was another little bit of distance the germs had to travel. And as with TB, fresh air was one of the main treatments. This is Camp Hospital 45 over in France. They reported, three large porches accommodated the pneumonias and were doubtless responsible to a large degree for the low death rate here. which averaged about 17.5%. That's a low death rate. It was noticed that many of the fatal cases were of a particularly rapid and virulent mixed infection, resulting in a very massive form of pneumonia. As you can imagine, the influenza epidemic affected nurses as well. At Camp Cody, New Mexico, 75 of the 100 nurses got sick, and 5 of them died. And flu would cause the overwhelming majority of nurse deaths. This is a funeral procession for an Army nurse somewhere in France. We don't know where or who. A quote from the 1921 history of the nurse corps. In the case of deaths amongst the nurses, upon the chief nurse fell the duty of writing to the parents and describing the details as best she might, of readjusting the duties among already overworked women, of assisting at funeral ceremonies, of keeping up morale, and also of arranging for the nursing of other sick members. It takes but little imagination to picture the frame of mind of a chief nurse who had gone through this process 12 times in 1 month, as often happened during the period of the influenza epidemic. The cumulative effect of so many funerals would have had serious consequences under normal conditions, and 3,000 miles from home, in a foreign land, it took strong character to withstand the pressure. Now, the chief nurse who had 12 of her nurses die in 1 month, at the funerals, she stopped looking at them in the face because she said she was starting to wonder who was going to go next. Now, coming out of the Victorian era, there was a cult of motherhood, and across that, of course, with the nurses being female, and I think there's an extra level of interest in nurse funerals. I don't think you would get this kind of scene for two male infantry officers who are going to be buried. It's different. Nurses did receive all the military courtesies in their funerals. Helen Fairchild, there on the left, died of anesthesia complications after stomach surgery, and the nation recognized her services with a military funeral. British, Canadian, Australian, and French representatives also attended, and she was also buried in the military cemetery.
This next segment will look at the living conditions and leisure activities available to nurses during World War I. So in France, the facilities for heating were often poor, as you've heard, and the barracks and wards were chilly. And some of the nurses were put out of commission temporarily by chilblains because they had such cold water in which they were forced to dip their hands. One report read, "For the nurses, the question of laundry led to much discomfort. In many cases, they had to launder their own clothing, including uniforms, which was a hardship, because their physical strength was already taxed from taking care of so many patients. This washboard that you see on the slide came with a handwritten note which said, 'The little washboard was used to help clean our clothes in the AEF and also used as a backrest. Very useful.' And this is Nurse Abby Johnson in Base Hospital number 60. Now, interestingly, the nurses did say, because they noticed that the wounded were always or almost always in good spirits in spite of their pain, 'Why shouldn't I be cheerful?' remarked one nurse. 'No matter which way I look, I see someone worse off than I am.' This is a Red Cross nurse group. They have not yet received their Army Nurse Corps uniforms, and they are at Base Hospital number 21 that had formerly been stables for a racetrack in France. These are doctors and nurses with their patients in France in 1918. And here are Red Cross workers assembling surgical dressings in France in 1918. There are written accounts of nurses speaking to the need for a constant supply of dressings, and sometimes they needed to use their own time to wash and wrap dressings as well. Just imagine the effort needed to keep hospitals supplied with this simple supply. These Army nurses are at Camp Shelby, Mississippi. Not exactly a looked forward to leisure activity, but someone had to keep the nurses' quarters clean. This is a surgical ward in France in 1918, and you notice the Victrola record player. So it's difficult to imagine life now. We have computers and tablets and cell phones and earphones, and this technology then, everybody got to hear whatever was on the record, whether you liked it or not. And so imagine what technology can happen 100 years from today. These are mastoid patients. They're in a base hospital in France, and you heard that there were no antibiotics at this time. And so if you had an ear infection that then did travel and make an abscess in your brain, you were headed for skull surgery there, or you might have become deaf, or you might have had pressure on your facial nerves that also required surgery because you could have had facial paralysis. So mastoiditis was really a big deal. And at this time also, they had contagious buildings, and they designated those for patients with meningitis, chickenpox, scarlet fever, diphtheria, and measles. And the nurses that worked with these patients were also quarantined and isolated, but they still did have days off. This is an American Red Cross evacuation hospital in France, and you'll see again numbers of patients and types of wounds. This is an operating room, base hospital number 52. This is three tables, and they are putting dressings on patients who have had thighs or arms amputated. This is December 14, 1918. This is the Aviation Instruction Center in France, and it shows a camp hospital and how you would have heat and what type of environment, and the sheets making the cubicles again in the back. The next segment here is the nurses' quarters, and they came in many styles. This slide shows a stove used by the nurses with the British Expeditionary Forces in France, and you notice there's coal for heat and a kerosene lamp for light. This is the interior of nurses' quarters in a camp hospital, number 24, and this light has a fabric shade cover. There are curtains, dresser scarves, and photos on the wall. Certain locations, the nurses would fall upon buildings and they'd need to clean it, whether it was a chateau or a cottage or whatever quarters. And then the very next day, they might receive orders that they had to move. One nurse wrote, "How very often afterwards do I remember having helped to make some chateau a decent place to live, and I moved out the very next day. We began to think we had been sent to Europe to clean it up." At another chateau, officers occupied the rooms on the second floor. The nurses were on the third and fourth, and that top floor was where the night shift would try to sleep. All the cooking happened in the basement, and they had a surgery room in the dining room. They also had a shock ward on the first floor, and what they did not care for was the atmosphere in the bomb-proof place in the cellar where they were ordered to go during air raids. This is a photo of a nurse working in American Red Cross Evacuation Hospital in France. Environmental and logistical factors made life difficult for nurses because it's difficult to do things when you are in long periods of enforced blackouts, so the enemy cannot see you. This caption is Nurses' Quarters France, and you'll see different styles of quarters here. These ladies are lucky enough to have a piano. And here is a fireplace and a piano. This is in France, 1918. This is Camp Devens, Massachusetts. It's the living room of the nurses' quarters. And when they were stateside, they could go to town. They could walk in the parks, maybe see a movie. But when you were overseas, you needed to make your own fun. It might be group singing. It should not be too much fun with your presenters up here. I guess we could have kazoos, but I don't know if you want to hear us sing. And if you were lucky, again, you could play a piano. These nurses are resting at the American Red Cross Nurses Club in London, England, and they are wearing their blue straw hats, so you know it's summer, and they are overlooking the gardens at Buckingham Palace, and inside, they're in the conservatory of that same club. This is nurses' reception room in England in 1918. Yes, another piano. And this is a photo that probably didn't happen a whole lot. This is a cast of nurses, officers, and enlisted men who put on a patriotic play, The Democracy Victorious. This is July 4th, 1918 in France. This is a souvenir belt made by patients at base hospital number 10 for Army nurse Imogene Lloyd. It's British. It's covered in the tartan of the Gordon Highlanders. They attached their insignia, their buttons, their cap badges, and ranks from all the regiments that she helped take care of. Most of her patients were British. And the third insignia from the end that circled is a badge of the Royal Tank Corps because tanks were invented during this war. This is examples of trench art. Army Nurse Edna Dunlap, who you saw as the, we don't know her age, but she's over 35. Yes, this is her canteen, or at least a canteen that was decorated for her. And not all trench art, of course, happened in the trenches. Some were occupational therapy, some were done on the ship home, some were done, you know, so you had to use your non-dominant hand to do things. So you see the A, the N, and the C on the caduceus there. The mess kit was from an officer from her same unit, and it documents his deployment.
So we're gonna start wrapping up here now, and I'm gonna talk about a couple of things that were firsts that happened in this war. Nurse anesthetists were used for the first time in the Army. Now, Sanders talked about specialty teams, but nurse anesthetists were truly the Army's first advanced practice nurses. The Army made an arrangement in the spring of 1918 to send six nurses to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, to take a course on the administration of anesthesia. And they did 50 cases on their own, and then they graduated. And in September of 1918, another 15 nurses went to the Mayo Clinic to learn how to do anesthesia. And they would go back, and they would train other nurses and physicians and corpsmen on how to administer anesthesia. And they were among those who specialized in the surgical, psychiatric, orthopedic, and emergency nursing on the shock teams. And these were really the first time that nurses had pushed beyond traditional medical surgical roles and specialized, pushing the boundaries of nursing on the battlefield. And another thing we've discussed today was that nurses really weren't supposed to be near the front. They weren't doctrinally designed to be near the front. But since they were, we have the first examples of nurses being lauded for bravery on the battlefield. And what you see on the left is the French Croix de Guerre. These were given to soldiers of all disciplines for bravery on the battlefield by the French. And there were several Army nurses that were given French Croix de Guerre for bravery under usually artillery. Additionally, you see the British Royal Red Cross, which is a nursing-specific medal, which still exists today. And the British gave the Royal Red Cross to nurses for heroic deeds on the battlefield. This is Beatrice MacDonald and Helen McClellan. You've heard of Helen McClellan a couple of times during this presentation. And these two women were pushed up and into the battlefield, moved forward in July of 1917. They were assigned as members of British number 61 casualty clearing station. They were working, they were supporting the British, and on the night of August 17th, they had a artillery shell come into their tent and explode when it hit the ground. And Miss MacDonald was struck by shrapnel and hit in the eye and the cheek. And her tent mate, Miss Helen McClellan, immediately began to care for her. MacDonald was placed on a stretcher. She was taken out of there. She went to an eye hospital. Unfortunately, she ended up losing her eye, but upon recovery, she was now sightless in the right eye, and she returned to duty. She became a chief nurse of an evacuation hospital. She stayed for the remainder of the war. She became the first woman in the United States to be awarded the Distinguished Service Cross for bravery, and McClellan also was awarded one. This is 25-year-old Lenny LaCrone and her good buddy Irene Robar. They were two nurses assigned to Shock Team 134. They augmented Field Hospital number 127. They were pushed forward as a member of a shock team, and they were both awarded the Citation Star, the predecessor to the Silver Star, for gallantry in action during an artillery barrage on July 28, 1918. The Citation Star was this little tiny quarter of an inch star which you wore on your World War I victory medal. And if someone were to see that, they would know that you were cited for gallantry in action. And the the soldiers of World War I weren't particularly enthralled with the Citation Star because it was this little tiny thing. There was no pomp and circumstance that was associated with awarding this particular medal. So they appealed to the Army, and in 1929, they changed it to the Silver Star. This is Lenny LeCrone's citation, lauding her for bravery. And if you'll notice here, it was infrequent enough that women were cited for bravery that they actually lined through the pronouns and changed them to something more appropriate. Believe it or not, the regulation which governs Silver Star medals still has a provision in it allowing for transition to the Silver Star. So Sanders and I, about 8 years ago, got involved with researching this story, and we got a hold of the awards branch, and we had the Citation Stars converted and given to the families. And if you recall, I mentioned that the Citation Star was this little quarter of an inch silver star that still exists to this day in the center of the Silver Star medal. And this is a picture of Major General Gail Pollock, who's the acting Surgeon General, giving the Silver Star to Lenny LeCrone's daughter. Yeah, it was a, thank you. It was a wonderful, wonderful project. And I will tell you that the day that they brought this in, the daughter brought this in, and that we got to hold this and see this for ourselves, it was a really special, I think, moment for us. This is Jane Rignall right here. She's the chief nurse of Mobile Hospital number 2. She was awarded the Citation Star for gallantry in action during a artillery bombardment in July of 17th of 1918. Basically, the hospital was getting shelled, and she and the nurses stayed in the area and continued to take care of the patients despite the danger. She was likely, as far as we know, the first woman eligible to wear the Silver Star Medal. And she also had her Citation Star converted to a Silver Star, and we mailed that to her family. So the movement towards rank for nurses gained momentum with the realization that the Army had no policy for demobilizing nurses. What happened was the Army nurses had no status. So they had no rank, and they had a different obligation that under which they came into the Army for. It was a duration of the emergency, and it was different from that which the enlisted guys had. And what that meant was they found themselves continually bumped off of transport ships to go home. So some of them, even in April of 1919, there were still 7,000 Army nurses left in theater because they just couldn't get them home. And the nurses were viewed as volunteers. They weren't draftees. So the priority was given to demobilizing these enlisted men. And because of that, you can see here, as late as June of 1919, there's still 4,500 nurses in theater. But because of that, rightly or wrongly, people started to associate this lack of rank and status as one of the primary reasons why these folks were stuck there. So in the spring of 1919, because of their performance in the war and because of this lack of status and the problems it created, a grassroots movement developed in the United States to give nurses rank. So in 1920, when the Army reorganized, the Army Reorganization Act gave relative rank to Army nurses. And they didn't have real rank. They weren't able to issue orders that were legally binding. They still got paid less than their counterparts of equal titled rank. But it was some progress, and then the full legal rank, which Army nurses enjoy today with colleagues of all officer corps in the Army, wouldn't happen until the Army-Navy Nurses Act of 1947.
So in wrapping up, we have the impact of World War I on nursing today. And while you read that slide, because we're running over here, I would just like to read a few more quotes to you, please. So Julia Stimson again verified, one doctor and one nurse work at each table, and you can imagine what surgical work the nurse has to do, no mere handling of instruments and sponges, but sewing and tying up and putting in drains while the doctor takes the next piece of shell out of another place. Then after 14 hours of this, with freezing feet, to a meal of tea and bread and jam, and off to rest if you can, in a wet bell tent, a damp bed without sheets, after a wash with a cup full of water. And another nurse wrote, the stupendous work of reconstruction, unheard of in any previous war, has just begun in this country, and we've had the privilege of sharing in it. And every patient, more especially the amputation case, has a psychological problem. And the greater his disability, the greater his problem. Often, this is only in his eyes. He thinks he's an object of pity. He's lost his status. He's lost his walk of life, and he shrinks from anything approaching sympathy with a feeling of horror. But nurses have the right spirit. They can do more to restore a maimed soldier's mental poise than can anyone else by carefully avoiding even a suggestion of pity or hero worship. They may daily and hourly influence him in such a way that he gradually finds himself, and they can help prove to him that he need only be as useless as he himself chooses to be. And another quote I would like to read is from, I'm going to say Colonel Julia Flickey, because that's what she was when she was done with her career, but during World War I, she does not have any rank, and she ends up being chief of the Army Nurse Corps from 1937 to 43, right before Blanchfield. But anyway, during World War I, she served on hospital train number 55 and a base hospital, and she wrote in her book, always under military control, yet not a soldier, often under hostile fire, but forever a non-combatant, sometimes stationed in remote back areas, but everywhere in contact with the grim business of war. In all the other far-flung places where this country's fighting men are stationed is the Army nurse. Now, for paving ways for nurses at the front, these nurses, as you know, were not trained for many of these situations. And when they came to the air raids, this is what protocols they had come up with. They already had tents and huts sandbagged. They already had dugout shelters dug. But upon signal that there was an air raid about to happen, they would lower helpless patients' beds to the floor by folding under the legs of each cot. Those that could would accompany those to the nearest trench, but one nurse always stayed with the patients who were so tied up to frames that they couldn't lower the beds. And then we heard of the improvised patient warming device. You saw that. You know that they had patient drives and mass cals and triage, and that their scope of practice grew larger, which actually will happen to any healthcare provider during any war. And then our specialty roles of nursing became more and more clearly defined for the anesthetist, the operating room. Hospital trains no longer exist, but it did at the time, and through the Korean War, really, shock nursing and then psychological nursing. And we're beginning to realize that you can't be the Renaissance nurse anymore, that there's got to be some type of specialization that occurs. Societal impacts, again, one third of all graduate nurses in the United States served in the Army Nurse Corps during World War I. And American nurses were considered to be the finest in the world because the U.S. socially accepted women in that profession. Of Colonel Blanchfield, her commanding officer in World War I had written about her, that she handled very difficult situations successfully in extreme efficiency, and she was invaluable under existing conditions. So I think those efforts helped towards societal impacts.
So just a couple of wrap-up notes. About 90% of the pictures that you saw here today came out of the National Archives. Some of them were pictures that we've selected before for previous projects that we've worked on. And the pictures were due to efforts like soldiers that you see here, Sergeant First Class Clarence Johnson, and PFC John Dedette, who are Signal Corps photographers. Also, as you can imagine, nobody really wants to take pictures of combat that's 10 feet away. So a lot of the scenes that we used for combat were from combat artists. And they were guys like George Harding, who was a illustrator for Harper's Monthly, and actually published a portfolio of his World War I work called The American Expeditionary Forces in Action. And this is the National Archives in College Park, Maryland, where a lot of the pictures came from. This was an incredibly well-documented war. The American Journal of Nursing dedicated quite a bit of each particular issue during that time frame to things that were going on in the Army in the war. The Army Medical Department in the 20s wrote a series of 14 books that chronicalized its planning and execution of the war. And then there's been several other books that have been written about the Army Medical Department in the war since. And there's quite a bit of original source material that still exists in archives, both in the National Archives and in the archives at the Surgeon General's office. So thank you for your attention. Thank you to the KU School of Nursing. Thank you to the museum. Thank you for spending your Saturday afternoon with us. And we would be happy to entertain any questions that you have.
Any questions? Could you please come down to these microphones here if there's any questions from the audience?
I have a loud voice. I know we're late. I have one quick question. How many nurses died in World War I?
There weren't very many nurses that died. There was somewhere around 240 that died from the flu. There were there was one nurse that fell out of the airplane. And there were a couple of nurses. Oh, didn't mention her? There was one nurse that died on a basically joyriding trip on an airplane. She fell out, and oddly enough, in the Vietnam War, there were quite a few nurses that died joyriding on helicopters. So additionally, there were a couple, literally two nurses, that died on the way over when they were on a battleship, and the battleship was testing its guns, and it fired the guns into the water, and the blast reflected backward off the water and hit a couple of nurses that were watching from the boat. But unlike in other wars, like World War II, the Korean War, Vietnam, and this most recent war, there weren't any Army nurses that died as a direct result of wounds sustained in combat.
Thank you.
It's a great question. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Or sirs. I can't see. Sorry.
Okay. When I look back at the tools that they had and the lack of medication and everything else, I'm just very curious if there are stats on how many wounded there were and what was the death rate. I mean, how many of those wounded survived?
92% of the ones that made it back to a hospital survived.
92% that made it to a hospital.
Right. Now, that's not everybody that gets hit, but 92% of the those that got admitted to a hospital survived.
And the Army's very good at keeping statistics. I'm being serious. On killed in action and wounded in action, but it's not particularly useful to compare from war to war because weapons change, tactics change, equipment to protect soldiers change, and healthcare changes.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Why did the physicians have strychnine?
Well, it's lethal, so that was restricted to physicians. I think it can be used to in very low doses. It helps heart function, but like some of the other medicines that were in the pharmacopoeia then, like mercury and arsenic, which were anti-VD drugs. The dosage range is really tight, so okay. That was it was a physician-only thing, I think.
Okay. Any other questions? All right, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Coming to this unique event.